About five questions, and each of them will have 2 minutes to answer the question. So they're all going to answer the same question, and then when we're finished with the moderator's question, each of you should have been given an index card to fill out if you have a question, and I would ask that the question that you ask will be the type of questions that will be able to be answered by all three of the candidates. We don't specifically want a question specifically for one candidate. We're not looking for attack kinds of questions. We're looking for informational questions. We're going to go ahead and get started. And we'll start with Kenya. Would you like to start with your 3 minute opening statement? Yeah. No, you can stand for this fine. If you need an extra minute or two, we can take 3 minutes from Kevin.
He knows I talk a lot.
So, all right.
Hi, my name is Kenny Gibson. I'm a Richmond resident. I've lived here for about 10 years. I've got 2 kids in Richmond Public Schools. I'm very active in the PTA. And in the process of living here, my social justice passion has been public education. I'm concerned about the amount of funding that we have in our schools, concerned about the lack of diversity that we have in our schools, concerned about the high concentration of poverty that we have in our schools. What I'm most taken by is the reality that our racist history has broken our education system, and we've been trying to solve it with multiple choice tests. And we are arguing about the tests, and meanwhile, companies are making millions and millions of dollars. So ultimately, I'd like for us to find a way to come together and work together so that we can have that future that we really wish to have. I'm not a person who ever in a million years thought I'd run. I never thought I'd be in the PTA, but I'm here today, and look forward to hearing about the other candidates who I'm excited to learn from. I'm excited that in the 3rd District we've got so many folks that care and believe in public education.
Thank you, Kate. Joanne, would you like to go next?
My name is Joanne Henry. I've been with the public schools for 30 years, and I'm also concerned about the education of our students. But right now, we're talking about the 3rd District. And in the 3rd District, what I'm concerned about is, first of all, we have a lot of young people moving into our district, and I would like to see them stay in this 3rd District instead of paying their taxes in a 3rd District in Richmond City and having our children go to private schools. I would like to see their children stay in Richmond Public Schools so our enrollment can go up. And my second is for the 3rd District is to make sure we have excellent education so our kids can be productive and they can go out and get jobs. Right now, one of my concerns is not only for the 3rd District, but the whole school district is we're having problems with reading and writing, and I would like to help solve that problem. Again, I have been a citizen of Richmond for 30-something years. I had 2 daughters who graduated from John Marshall High School. They went to Richmond Public Schools from grade K through 12, and they received an excellent education. So again, I am here to improve all the children in Richmond Public Schools' education, but as far as the 3rd District is concerned, which I'm running for, I want to make sure that we have an excellent schools in the 3rd District.
Thank you, Dr. Henry. Second question.
Sure. Hello, my name is Cindy Menzer, and I am running for school board for a few reasons. One is that I have 2 little girls, one of whom just started in pre-K at Holton. And my family is a middle-class white family with all the privileges that brings. And I care deeply about equity in education, and I recognize that my privilege has meant that I can move into a neighborhood with a good neighborhood school, and if that school's not good, that I can choose something else. And when I think about the kids across Richmond, the 24,000 kids that are a part of our schools, not every family has the privilege that my family has. And when I think about that as a parent, it breaks my heart when I think about being a parent that can't choose the best, that doesn't have all the opportunities that I have for my kids, that every parent wants for their kids. That's why I've decided to run. But that doesn't qualify me to be on the school board. That does give me the passion, I think, for this work. What I think qualifies me to be on the school board is my experience working in education. Prior to coming to Richmond, my last full-time job was running an anti-poverty organization in the South Bronx, where we supported families with young kids to help them stabilize and ultimately get out of poverty. The reason that we worked with families with young kids is because the time period of between 0 and 5 years old is one of the most important developmental time periods in a kid's life. So we wanted to help families stabilize so that they could invest in their kids for years. We also focus on that group because when kids get to kindergarten, they're either on track or they're behind. And if they're behind without some serious intervention, it's highly unlikely that they will be able to catch up. So we focused on that particular age group. Prior to that, I ran an organization that worked with New York City Public Schools that trained parents and teachers and kids together to bridge the divide between what was happening in the home and in the school building. During the course of my time there, I worked with a collaboration that won $23 million to the New York City school system to provide training for parents and kids and provide access to technology, which was computers and broadband access. It was a collaboration that allowed me to work in over 100 high poverty middle and high schools across New York. And through that experience, I had a chance to see things that work and some of the things that don't work. So I want to use my experience elsewhere and bring that here. I am fairly new to Richmond, and so it's kind of amazing that I'm standing here before you, and was quite honored that the board appointed me to take Jeff Warren's seat back in March. And in my time on the school board, I've been able to invest my time in learning, working with teachers and principals across the third district and across the school district as a whole, to begin to understand what it is that the community has, what are the assets and resources that Richmond has, and there are many. To be able to start changing the way that Richmond Public Schools are serving our kids. So a few things that I'd like to do I'm currently on the school board, but also if I continue. One is that I think we really need to focus on our talent. I think we need to hire a chief talent officer who is focused on strategic recruitment of principals and teachers and who is really investing in bringing good talent to our district, providing strong professional development, and then ensuring that we keep that good talent in our system. Ultimately, principal leadership, I think, is one of the most important pieces to getting it right in our schools, because they keep good teachers, and good teachers are the number one thing that impact kids' education on a day-to-day basis. There are, of course, many things we need to do to retain teachers, but first off is that we need to get them here. As you all probably know, we had a lot of open slots at the beginning of this year, and I wanna make sure that we don't do that again. But that we're ensuring we're filling the slots with highly qualified teachers. I also want to be a part of connecting the dots between what's happening outside of the school buildings and what's happening inside the school buildings. I'm a big supporter of the Education Compact, and the reason I'm a supporter of that is because I think, one, we need to collaborate better as a city for outcomes for our kids, and two is because poverty is impacting so many of our families, and that means that when kids get into the school building, they have challenges to learn. They have challenges of trauma. They have challenges of not having gotten the best early childhood care that they needed. So I wanna make sure we're providing comprehensive services to families that are holistic, that starts prenatally and goes through high school graduation. And ultimately, we need to focus on ensuring that all of our kids are graduating with college-ready or career-ready diplomas. And that should be our ultimate goal. I'm really excited to get a chance to be here with you all tonight. Thank you for putting this on, and I'll move to the next question.
Thanks. Our first question, and we're going to take turns in terms of who goes first for each of the questions. So for this time, Joanne, would you go first? Dr. Hannah? Question for you, Dr. Henry, and for all of the other school board candidates. If elected, what are the one or two initiatives that you will champion to improve the quality of education for the children in the third district? Can you talk a little bit about this and elaborate on that?
In the third district, the schools are accredited except for one, and one is aren't provisional. But we have to now stop focusing on STEM programs where our students are engaged in science, technology, technology, engineering, architect, which is STEAM now. But then I just read where there it is they have incorporated reading into that STEM, gone from STEM now to STEAM and mathematics. Our kids are now doing the traditional setting, which now it's not appropriate for them to learn that traditional setting. We do need technology in the schools, in all schools. And in fact, Comcast gave Richmond Public Schools 6,000 computers. But I'm not certain where those computers went to, but they need to be in the classroom with the kids and the teachers engaging online doing research. They need to be, students now need to be able to do things that real life situations. That is going to help our children to excel now instead of that traditional setting. I understand now that Richmond Public Schools has incorporated Edgenuity, which is one of the best curriculums in the country. And what Edgenuity does is these kids are in the classroom, they're working together in groups, and they are discussing just the real life situations, and the teacher is the coach. This is the movement that we need to be going into now. And of course, yes, our kids, we always say our kids are in poverty. I also work with them as well for 30 some years at Armstrong High School. They came into our school hungry, upset about a lot of things in the community, but they had that love and consistency, and people cared about them, and our teachers also. And then our teachers did not leave, but the key problem to that was we had good administrators, we had good educators, and we don't have that now. We do need good leaders. We need to find those good leaders, put them in a school to help our teachers so they can teach and be in charge of their own classrooms. That's how they're gonna learn. We feed our kids now from when they come into our schools, they're eating breakfast. At first we said that they were hungry, they couldn't think, but we're feeding them now. So when they come into that classroom, they get their breakfast, so there's no reason they can't think. But another key thing is, we got to look at the data. We have overage kids in elementary, middle school, and high school. That is one of our key problems. Yes, when they started early education, we should, again, I go around to different schools in the summertime. Two-year-old kids are doing STEM. So we have to get away from the traditional setting there and introduce the more modern things, technologies, into STEM.
Thank you, Dr. Can you talk to me next?
So I'm in chief, pick three. So if I was elected, there are three things that are really close to my heart. And it's hard to pick three even because we all know there's no silver bullet that's going to get us through this, right? This is something that we created over centuries, and it's not going to take us 5 years to get us out. But there are three things that I think are key to solving this puzzle that we're in. The first is exceptional education. As a parent, I've navigated the system, and as I've looked for accommodations to best suit my kids as they are
learning in school. What I've come to find out is those things that are great for a kid with special needs are often great for every kid. When we're looking at what the advancements are in education, by and large, those advancements are happening as we're looking to teach those kids that learn differently. So a kid with ADHD, you know, this is someone that maybe doesn't, you know, want to be in don't want to be sitting in one place the whole time. It's great to have more recess, right? Or break up the day more. But that's not just good for a kid with ADHD. That's good for every kid. Or a kid with dyslexia. We know that, you know, a reading method that is multisensory is great for a kid that has dyslexia, but that's not just good for a kid with dyslexia. That's good for every kid. So rather than trying to put kids into a box, let's look at how we can use those advancements to reach every kid. The second piece that I believe is worth exploring is how we work together, right? We all are in our own silos. We ignore the elephant in the room. The elephant in the room is that we don't talk to each other. So the fact is that we are all trying to accomplish the very same things, and yet we're fighting each other. We want to say that one person is trying to do one thing and another group is trying to do something else, but if we were to even just talk to each other, we might all be trying to do the same thing. As an advocate, I work with a lot of teachers, and because those teachers came from certain schools, people might think they were trying to advocate for just their schools, right? But the fact of the matter is we're all trying to do the same thing, and I'm trying to figure out how we can really work together. The third thing that I think is important to address along those same lines is the fact is our school system is a majority-minority school system. So as a minority-majority school system, how can we use that as a whole? That can be awesome, right? So there's been research that's been done that shows that there was a school where they taught the kids the system wasn't fair. And, you know, we're always growing up talking about how things are supposed to be fair and that the things are, you know, should be fair. But the fact of the matter is for many of us, the system's not fair. And so when you go to a school that's largely a school that's filled with brown kids, right, and all of those kids come from a neighborhood where people are living in poverty, and you've been told that the system is fair, where do you think that you can go? So I think that it's worth exploring in a school system like ours that's a majority-minority school system, what would our schools look like and how could our kids go farther if we allow them to appreciate the challenges that we all live with every day. Thank you.
Thank you, Jim.
Two things, and I mentioned this before, that I think are really important. Number one is talent. And what I mean by that is our people, our leaders, our principals, our teachers, are the absolute most important thing that we have to be able to educate our kids. And I think we need to do a better job. I think we need to stop thinking about it as HR. I think we need to start thinking about it as talent, as people who come to our system who need to be treated like the most important resource that we have. Things I would recommend. Number one, that we hire a chief talent officer who reports directly to the superintendent who does strategic talent initiatives. Recruitment that happens year-round, not just at certain times of the year. That we provide consistent professional development that is tailored to individual schools, that makes sense for what teachers are dealing with in the classroom, for example, providing professional development around trauma-informed care. And three is that we really think about retention. So that means thinking about the way that we're compensating our teachers to be more competitive in the market. It takes into account things like ensuring that teachers have some choice in how they interact in their classrooms, how they're teaching, that there's some autonomy there. I also think we need to build a stronger pipeline for principals. Right now, we don't have a pipeline either within RPS or to get principals into RPS from outside of the system. So I think we need to be building a pipeline with our assistant principals and our teachers to put them into leadership. I also think we should think strategically about partnering with a local university to build our pipeline of principals from outside of the district. Things like career changers, so opportunities for people to get into education who may be already in management situations in other organizations. So I think talent is the number one thing. The second thing I would focus on is making sure we have 21st century facilities for our kids to be learning in. I'm currently the chair of the facilities committee, working very hard to make progress to ensure that we get the funding we need to correct some of the dilapidated facilities in our system. But that's not all. I also think we need to be focusing on the culture and climate within our buildings. So again, providing support around trauma-informed care, ensuring that we're thinking about our discipline practices from a restorative justice perspective, so that we aren't kicking kids out of buildings, but keeping them in school. And the third thing I would do is focus on bridging the gap between out-of-school time and in-school time. I think we need to provide consistent after-school programming for kids, for all kids across the city. We need to provide safe transportation for those programs, so that working parents have somewhere safe and high quality for their kids to go after school. I'd like to see us think about how we're working with parents more effectively. One recommendation that I'd like to make is that we hire a parent coordinator for every building, every school across the district, and that person's job is to engage with parents, ensure parents feel welcome in a building, provide training for parents on how to be involved with their kids' education. Those are the three things that I would like to focus on. I know you said two, but those are the top three. Thank you.
Thank you. Our next question, we'd like to start with you because you know, the next question is, do you support the school modernization referendum, which will be on the November ballot? Yes or no, and why, for your answer. Now, I'll just take a second and speak to the referendum for a second so everyone can understand what we're talking about. Paul Golden, along with the Crusade for Voters, this summer worked on going out to get signatures. I believe we got about 16,000 signatures. And what the referendum basically says is that it puts on the shoulders of our mayor that he's got to come up with a plan to modernize our schools. And the concern initially was, you know, many people, when you say you're going to put taxes on, you know, they get a little frightened. So as part of that plan, the plan says he's got to come up with a plan to modernize our schools with existing funds. And that's, what's it, $700 million budget we have in the city of Richmond? So that's what that plan basically says. And to date, we haven't got a lot of support from people who are currently in office. We got a lot of support from folks who are not in office, but folks who are in office, we haven't got a lot of support from, whether it be delegates, council people, or school board members. Please, go ahead. Thank you.
Yeah, I mean, I went to City Hall myself and advocated for getting additional funding for our capital project last year, and you know, we didn't get enough so that the school board right now can actually do anything with the money, right? So the school board is sitting on $14 million, and it's not enough to build a new school with, and so we're stuck doing nothing. So. So I support anything that can get us to do something. We've got a lot of plans. We talk a lot. We all know that the problems are there. I think that the charter change is unconventional, but clearly we need to do something unconventional to make something happen because we've been talking about it for a very, very, very long time. So I also support, you know, option five. That's what we've got. We agree to it. Let's go and get it done. I believe that as it pertains to redistricting, we've got to go ahead and move forward with that as well. We, you know, there are things that are difficult to do. Finding the money should, of all the things, should be relatively doable in this complex kind of way. So I do support it. That said, you know, there's some other charter changes I'd like to see too while we're at it. I think staggered terms would be an important thing to address, and would love to see that discussion begin to happen as well.
Thank you. Dr. Andrew, would you like to go next?
Well, of course, you know, I supported it because I walked around from door to door getting signatures. And unfortunately, Richard Public Schools doesn't have the money. City Hall and Senate, they did not have the money. I applaud Mr. Dover for going out and all of us who went out to get those signatures so we could put it on a ballot on November 17th and vote on it and then put it back into the mayor's lap so we can hear what he has to say, and he has 6 months to make a decision on that. So yes, I'm for it.
Thank you, Dr.
I think it's significant that 16,000 folks said that this is important. I think it's a great showing that the community cares and wants something to happen with facilities. I, as I mentioned, am on the facilities committee and working very hard to get something in front of city council and the mayor. I'm hopeful that we will be able to find the funding for it. I've had conversations, many of them about various ways to finance schools. I think we need to get creative and innovative about how we do that. And ultimately, I think the voters will come out on November 7th to let the city know how important facilities are.
Now, do you or do you not support the modernization plan? Yes or no?
You know, I am careful to support something that I think will circumvent the power and authority that the school board has. And I hope that we're going to be able to put forth a plan that is fundable really soon.
Is your answer yes or no?
Yep. No, I don't support it in the way that it's written.
Okay. Our next question, we're going to get you back up there, Sandy.
Sure.
Many of the parents whose children attend George Mason Elementary School were deeply concerned about the condition at that school. Yet the current school board voted to keep the school open. If J.B. Jeff Stewart or Gunner Park's building was in the same condition, would you vote to send the children in the third district to that school?
Mm.
I visited George Mason for the first time in June, and I was called. And I think we should be, and we need to make a plan to get the kids out of George Mason. You know, the end of August is not the right time to do that. I think we missed our opportunity to make that happen. And I think in a similar situation where there was a school in the third district, I would fight very hard to find an opportunity for them to be moved into a safe building. And if not, then I would ensure that what we've done at George Mason is make the best that we can, and now keep working to ensure we find a solution for George Mason. That situation got very tricky in August, because at that point, our options were limited. We couldn't build a new school. We couldn't move them into somewhere else where we wouldn't displace other kids. And I heard from folks both from Community High School and from Franklin saying, please don't disrupt this late in the game. And I also heard from families at George Mason. So I think that we need to be doing a facilities plan now, as we are, to ensure that we don't find ourselves in another situation too late in the game to make the best decision for all kids across the board. I regret that that's the decision that we had to make. But it was too late to move kids and have a domino effect across the district. My hope is that we deal with facilities now so that we don't have another George Mason on our hands come the end of this year, next year.
Thanks.
Would the facilities committee, I don't know when it was organized, but we have our schools every year, and every day we have our leaders in the schools. They look at the facility, they see we have problems. And I think, again, it goes back to leadership again. If you know you have a school that's run down and you're in that school, operating that school for 9 months, you have maintenance, you have custodial staff. You call the custodial staff will come to the principal and say, hey, we got a leak in our building. The principal, you're gonna put an order in and say, let's get it fixed. If the custodial staff cannot do that, then you call maintenance. That's why we have a budget, for maintenance to come in and help keep up our schools. I'm sorry about George Mason and what had happened to that school, but again, leadership, that's what it goes down to. And if that principal could not get what was done after he put his orders in, if he did not go down to the superintendent and the superintendent ignored that, then something is wrong with the leadership. And I think Mason is fine now. They put the money into the building. I don't think that the school board would not have approved those kids staying at George Mason once they went over there. They could see the condition, how it looked. And I didn't see all the school board members going over there at that particular time, but I saw a couple of them going to check over the building to make sure that the kids were safe. And again, we do not have money to just all of a sudden build a new George Mason because of the damage that is the condition of the school. So I'm gonna have to now agree with the decision that was made that the kids stay at George Mason. And it's fine, it looks nice. And also, as far as transporting the schools in August, we were saying that, oh, it's too soon. Again, we have staff. Teachers are already boxed and ready to, at the end of the school year, we have to put everything up because we don't know what is gonna go on during the summer. So if we really wanted to move kids to another school, they're already boxed up, all you have to do is just transport them. How long does it take you to move? How long does it take you to move from a year and a half? It doesn't take that long. But I can understand why Franklin did not want to be transported, because as long as I've been in the system, and Franklin Military was one of the first schools that I helped open up, sign the first piece of paper, they have been transported for the last 15 years. Every time a school closed, something is wrong with the school, Franklin Military has to go to Armstrong. Franklin Military had to go to somewhere else. So I can understand that. I really did. So that was a good move for our students to stay at George Mason. Unfortunately, teachers, you have nice classrooms now. And the key is educating our children. When are we going to stop thinking about the adults and really think about our children? It's a lot of politics.
Thank you, Ms.
So I would answer this question by saying that there are many schools in the third district and every district that are in a school condition. The school typically, the system typically gets a budget of like $1.5 million a year, and it works out to like 30 cents a square foot. And among the advocates that I worked with, we looked at other school systems, and over in Rico, I think it's like more than double that, if not triple that. And those buildings are considerably younger buildings, right? So so even a school like Holton that I send my kids to, it's gonna be falling apart. We're simply not spending enough money to maintain the buildings. John Marshall, there are air condition, air quality issues, and Henderson, there are issues, Park, there are issues. These are issues that are throughout the whole system. So going back to my point about staggered terms, right, we lost time. And I believe that we lost time because we had leadership and folks figuring out and understanding how the budget process works and getting to know each other, understanding their roles. We lost a lot of time that was really needed. So so I do think that staggered terms is a piece to consider. I think that it's unfortunate that we are in this cyclical pattern where, like I said, we've got money that we're sitting on, but yet we can't move forward with the plan. We have to address this problem holistically, right? We have to be looking at the whole district so that we're not just trying to put a Band-Aid solution onto one school like John Marshall, we want to find a solution that is something that's going to be long-term, right? Because these students, they're not like a Lego that we're going to just take apart and put back together from year to year to year. We want to put something in place that's consistent. We want families to know that that they know where their kids are going to be going to school in the fall. We want our teachers to know that they're going to be knowing what they're going to be teaching in the fall. We want to be proactive about it. So we need to get the funding in place to be able to maintain our buildings, to move forward with the plan, and we need to figure out ways that we can be more consistent and predictable and not continually putting out fires.
Okay, let me just ask this question to all three of you, make sure everyone's clear. So the question again is, if the situation at George Mason Elementary School was the same situation as one of the two schools that are in the third district, be it Jeb Stuart or be it Gunner Park, and you're on the school board, you're elected to the school board, how would you vote? Would you vote as this current school board did, George Mason, or would you vote not to send the children in the third district to such a school?
I mean, if I was elected to the school board, I would have made a stink about the facilities in January. I would have looked at the needs-based budget and submitted a plan to be able to take care of those things in the beginning of the year and not in August. If the circumstances came that in August nobody had done anything, I would take the recommendation of the Richmond Public School leadership, and if their recommendation was to stay in that building, but I'd say shame on us for letting it take so long.
And Joanne, how would you answer that? Make sure we're clear on your answer, the public clear on your answer.
Okay. I agree with what I'm saying, the same thing, that if that principal was in that school and he noticed that he had problems and he didn't report it, that's poor leadership. But if he reported it and it went downtown constantly, and somebody downtown in administration ignored it, then again, it's poor leadership.
So
I agree with what the divorce decision.
Okay.
Yes.
Sure. I mean, I voted to have the kids go back to George Mason, understanding that the superintendent was going to put all of the work into the building that got put in, and I would do the same, and it'd be if every single circumstance were the same, and I hope that it wouldn't be the case. But.
So it sounds like all three of you agree that if that situation was in the third district, you would vote to keep the school involved and send the kids back to Jeb Stuart or Kent Park. Is that correct?
Under the new conditions, yes.
You're looking well. Kenya, what's your answer?
Yeah, I mean, I just think we can't be in that situation again.
But what if you are?
Well, if you would look at the leadership then and who's doing the operations and say, you gotta look. We can't just keep allowing these things to happen over and over again, and think it's okay.
All right. We'll move on to our next question. And we'll start with, Cindy. Do you support charter schools and voucher systems for education? Please explain your answer.
I think this is a complicated question. I think vouchers are, and charter schools take away from public schools. I think charters were created to be able to test innovations. And I think there are things that we can learn from charter schools across our country and from the charter schools that exist in RPS. And some of those things are when we give principals autonomy, they can try new things, they run their own budgets, they are able to do a lot more innovation than what some of our traditional public schools are doing. Would I bring charter schools to Richmond Public Schools right now? I would not. I would not, because I think we have too many challenges in our system to bring in something else that would complicate it. I am not an advocate for vouchers across the board, but I do think there are things that we can learn from charters and the charters that exist currently in Richmond that are really valuable across public education. And so some of those things, and I would suggest that we should be thinking about these across Richmond Public Schools, but one is that we give principals more autonomy. Once we get the right leadership in place in every school, principals can run their own budgets, which means they can be the truly run their buildings and get to try innovative things that make a difference in kids' education. When principals have autonomy, ultimately that means teachers have autonomy. And I think those are some of the practices and principles that have made some charter schools successful that we could implement in our public school system.
Thanks. Okay, would you like to go next?
So I believe in public education. I believe that as a society, we have to ensure that every school is a good school. I don't support charter schools. I actually believe that charter schools were born because some business folks thought they could do it better. I think that the charter schools were born because as schools were becoming more diverse, people felt that they were failing and wanted to believe that they were failing. And we all bought into it, and we created an industry where there are companies making millions of dollars on the backs of our students. I believe that the realities of charter schools and some of them those things that Cindy referenced that allow some charters to do better, I don't think it has anything to do with the charter school, but rather with the policies in place, and that's something that's worth looking at. But by and large, I don't believe in a capitalist system that is going to improve our kids, right? I mean, the idea behind charters is that this competitive model allows schools to compete, and then you push the failures out, and that works fine for a cup of coffee, but no kid should be going to a losing school. So we need to find a way to ensure that every school is a good school. I think we wanted to believe that there would be a quick fix. We really wanted to believe that that there was something that a trick that we can place to solve. Again, what I'm saying is essentially a broken racist system. And there's no charter school, there's no quick fix, there's no software program that's going to do that. Ultimately, we have to take the time and go back to our roots and believe in public education and invest in public education if we want to see it improve.
Thank you, Ken.
First of all, we have a charter school. Patrick Henry is a charter school. Patrick Henry was not accredited when it first opened, and there was supposed to have been one of the best schools that they were going to put on the market for a charter school for Richmond Public Schools. And they're still not where they need to be. And as far as giving principals funding to run their own schools, we did that, done that before. And the principals they weren't creative. You do not need to give principals money to run a school. You need to just be creative and think out of the box. If you have a school, you have your teachers in there, we're paying our teachers to be creative and teach our kids, let them run their classrooms, but we have to step up. We have to do things differently from when I was in school, you were in school. Technology is the way we're going now. So if we use technology, STEM again, the STEM program, our kids will accelerate. They are going to learn. They are doing creative things. And in fact, in Richmond Public Schools, there are a lot of teachers doing creative things with their students. But we don't know it because Richmond Public Schools does not put it in the paper what our kids are doing. We have talented young students in Richmond Public Schools who are doing a lot. But for some reason, we hide everything. We need to start publicizing what our students are doing in Richmond Public Schools. And not only, yes, we may be failing 17 students are credited and the other ones are not, but those kids who are passing the SOLs, they are on track. Again, we have overage kids who are not going to pass SOLs because they can't read, they can't write, and they cannot do math. No matter how, and yes, if we are creative with these kids, we know they're behind two or three grade levels, there's five programs for them. We already have everything that Cindy mentioned. We've done it. 30 years in Richmond Public Schools, we've had after-school programs, we had surgery programs, we were accredited, and I know we've been accredited, we were accredited, the whole school district accredited one time, and then we had like 20-some schools accredited. Armstrong, for instance, was accredited for quite a bit. They got accredited the first time in 2004, and they stayed accredited until 2008. You know why? Because we had creative programs for our kids. We were thinking outside the box. I don't care how poor our kids are, their parents as well as our kids, they want to learn. And if we got the resources there, which Richmond Public Schools has the resources, we have all kind of resources to make our kids learn. You just don't know about it again because nobody's telling you about what we have in our school system. We're spending a lot of money, Title I money for programs for our students. We have Title I money and we have programs for these kids. We have community and schools supposed to be helping our kids. We just need good leadership. And it starts with the superintendent that you all are going to vote to bring into our school district that's going to know education. We got to have someone when he sits at that table with his cabinet and discuss education. It's got to be about all the kids. It doesn't matter about whether you're black or white or you're hungry, that you come from a low income over in Crady Court, Jackson Ward. It's not about that because, again, parents want their kids to learn. That superintendent will have to think out the box as well as be creative and tell his people, go out into the schools and see what those kids are doing. That's what we got to do. We cannot sit up on the 17th floor and just be happy and listen to every course. Now, Richmond Public Schools is good with putting stuff on paper. I know because I've seen it. Again, people, in order for Richmond Public School kids to be successful, we need leadership on City Hall, 17th floor. We need leadership into the school. Good principals, and when I say good principal, our principals need to be going to staff development. Teachers stay in staff development. That's all they know. But we have principals from all over, out of Richmond, Virginia, all over the United States, bringing principals in, and they're supposed to have ideas, and they don't have any ideas. We have assistant principals who have been at some of our schools for quite a long time. They know the school system. They can do a better job than sometime bringing in new principals.
Thank you, again, so the audience will be clear. Charter schools, support, yes or no? No.
I mean, I don't think it's a binary choice. I do not support bringing a lot of charters into it.
Joanne?
No.
All three by panelists say no. All right, Joanne, if you get there for the next question, it's your turn to go first. And this will be the last question that will come from the moderator. We're going to take questions that you have turned in, and we'll ask the candidates those questions next. And this is the last question that will come from the moderator. What are your views on the removing of the Confederate statue? First part of the question. And would you support renaming the elementary school and the third district named after the Confederate General, Jeb B. Stuart?
You know what? I think that's
that school should be named after Joanne Henry.
Oh, that was gold.
First of all, the statues made up on monument, and I continue to pass by and look at them all and wonder why they're standing up there on horses and whatever else they're on. And all I can say is take up space. And yes, Stuart name does need to be changed. And some other ones around here need to be changed too, as well. Yes. Let's name it Joanne.
I mean, I would love to see the monuments come down, and I would love to see us change Jim Stewart. What I would really love to see us do is fix our facilities, ensure that we're providing an equitable education for all kids across Richmond Public Schools, because ultimately I think those are the relics of slavery that still exist that are impacting our kids and our communities. So I support it very much, but I don't want us to just do the things that are on the surface. I want us to fix the systemic problems that exist with education.
I agree. It's a multi-pronged approach.
I support taking those statues down. I'm looking up more than admittedly, right, when I moved to the South, to Richmond, my husband was like, we're moving here, right? And it was a weird thing. I had to kind of get him over it a little bit. And I think for me personally, that there was something kind of, I saw something kind of ironic about those statues, that we could be this cool progressive city and yet still have those crazy statues up there. And admittedly, I think I was a little bit attached to them, almost like, like you have an uncle who's like hilarious and occasionally he like puts out really like inappropriate homophobic jokes. But you love him anyway, and you just kind of get used to him. And so that's how I thought about those statues. But really, I appreciate that. I mean, we need to take them down. And I think we need to take the statues down and we need to fix the schools. Michael Paul Williams wrote a great piece. I don't think that the statues are a binary choice. We can find a way, we can find the will, we can do a GoFundMe, we can take those statues down, and let's move forward with fixing the facilities. And likewise with Jeff Stewart. So I think let's change the name.
Okay. Can you stay up there for the next question? Elected to the third district school board seat, what plan do you have to address the abuses of special needs children and their families by RPS? Keep in mind that RPS is under investigation for its contribution to the school to prison pipeline.
I think that how we approach special education, we now call it exceptional education, is key. I think it has to start early on. I would like to see our whole approach in terms of moving, not being so fixated on putting kids into boxes and labeling our kids, but rather using those best practices for every kid. I think that as we look at the policy for discipline, I would like to see policy in place so that at the very least we don't have third graders that are getting suspended. I think that finding solutions is something that's going to take time, and it's a cultural change, clearly, as so many of these things are that we're talking about. But I do believe that there are policy opportunities that we can address, that we can look at our philosophy in how we approach exceptional education. And I do think that if we do that we can bring more families into the system. When I talk to my friends who also have kids that are unique in some way, they're equally frustrated too. This isn't an issue that is segregated, right? This isn't an issue that just poor folks have. This isn't an issue that just rich people have. This is something that everyone is concerned with, and we need to figure out a way to get it right. So I would be open to all thoughts and ideas as it would figuring out a solution for this. And I think it's complex too in a system like ours because how the flavor difference between issues with kids that are impacted by trauma and kids that are impacted by some sort of disability, it's a fuzzy line. And so I think it's going to require all hands on deck.
Stay for a second. We're going to ask a follow-up question to the other two candidates as well. Given that special education is under the law, and there's a specific law of how special education children should be treated, or as you said, exceptional education of children, if you as the 3rd District School Board representative know that law is being broken in the way that it's being administered to our children, our special needs children, what do you think your role as a school board representative should be?
So the laws are driven by the state, and when you go into one of those meetings, you get this book. It's like this thing, and it's about this thick, and it's overwhelming as a parent, and even as a parent like me who is OCD when it comes to reading and trying to understand the system. So. As a school board member, right, I can't sit in on an IEP meeting. I can't, I'm limited in the role of being able to change that individual situation until it gets to be that disciplinary action. And as I understand it, once it goes to the disciplinary team, you're faced with a bunch of stinky choices, right? So what I say is we need to look at what those stinky choices are and the ability that we have within the city to be able to change that. Let's go ahead and create better options to address discipline needs. And I do think that we need to work with the state and figure out ways that that the laws that exist are more understandable for folks. I think that it's complicated for everyone. Like I've sat in an IEP meeting, right, and there's terminology that the folks that are in the room with me don't know, right, and I don't know that I blame them as being failures or it's just complex. And so how can we simplify it? Which is why I do think that we need to move away from the labels and the boxes.
Thank you. Let me be clear on that second part of that question, if I could. You know that a law is being broken as it relates to special education. We're not talking about something that's subjective. We're talking about there's a law that's written down, that's in the books. It's been shown that what's happening is in adverse effect to what the law says should happen. What is your role as a school board member to have, and how do you act on that?
So in relation to that very specific question, as a school board member, it is definitely a part of my job to ensure that we are upholding the law. And what I would say is that if that is not the case, then we need to figure out where the breakdown is and address that. So if somebody is not upholding policy the way they should be, then they need to be disciplined and or removed if that's the case. What I think needs to happen right now is that we, as we hire a new superintendent, we ensure that they look into this situation, ensure that policy is being followed the way that it should be, all the way down the chain. Is there another part to the question?
First part was, what plans do you have to address the abuses of special needs children and that families are the
I agree with a lot of what Kenny said is the complications of exceptional ed and how IEPs are carried out. I do think that particularly in cases in urban areas where there is high poverty, intends to be that there's are more children that are labeled exceptional ed, and some of that comes from trauma, kids that are dealing with trauma that are showing behavior issues based on things that aren't necessarily a disability. So I think we need to provide more training and support for teachers in trauma-informed care, more supportive discipline practices across the board. And I think we then need to think about the options that exist when things do get to a disciplinary committee. But there are more options than suspension, expulsion, move to another school. We need to be thinking about how we're supporting kids in a much more restorative way that keeps kids in school buildings. We don't want to take them out of school. We want them to be in school learning. And so I think we need a superintendent who is going to pay attention to all of those different facets of exceptional education, and that we are providing more professional development for teachers across the board to support kids with challenges, with behavior, with trauma, so that we have less kids that are being designated as exceptional ed in the cases when it is not actually something that is necessary for them.
So I can repeat the question, I'll stop in.
First of all, as an educator and as assistant principal working at Armstrong High School, I had to deal with this situation. And the thing happens is, with our children with exception ed, we hire teachers supposed to have a degree in exception education and all the different exceptionalities, right? So when you hire these people, you put them in their classroom, they are supposed to know how to handle your child, the children, okay? And did you know, now in order to get into education, most teachers are going accepted education way now because it's quicker because the positions are open. When we hire people now, we're looking for exception education teachers because it's hard to fill. And another reason why is because of the test. You have to do a lot of tests now in order to get an exception ed. So if I'm going to hire an exception education teacher, you need to know how to teach my child. You need to know about IEPs. And do you know what an IEP is? I'm sure you all do. So when our kids sitting in a classroom, and I know this because when I used to go around doing my observations, kids are sitting in the classroom, cannot read. So, and the teacher's going to give you papers and tell you in history. You're going to go to a history class and you can't read, and the teacher's giving you something, telling you to do your assignment, do your homework, you can't read. Well, you're going to get disturbed in the classroom. What else are you going to get? But a child is going to act out. And again, exception education kids are overage kids in these classrooms because of the reason that they can't read and they can't do the math. And then teachers would give them puzzles or all kinds of things to entertain them instead of teaching them. Our exceptional education kids, they want to learn. They want to be able to read and write and be like other kids. And in fact, I will tell you what happened the other day at my school. A parent board came in to enroll into Dream Academy, which is an adult high school. She had her two other kids with her, and he was acting up, and he said, and she had to take them to Richard Public Schools. And he said, I don't want to be in an exceptional education class. I want to be in my regular class because the teacher said that I can learn, and that's where he wanted to be, audience. Again, we got to stop blaming our parents and everybody else for mistakes that we're making in schools, not only Richard Public Schools, but other schools. Now, how I see and we should not expel a kid every time you tell a teacher to shut up or I'm not going to do this or that. We are adults, we're paying with the college for a high school diploma. We need to know how to teach that kid. Do not go into that profession if you're not going to teach exceptional education kids. It is a hard area for the kids to be in. I think downtown, we have a compliance specialist in the schools. They supposed to be able to work with our exceptional education teachers to help them to be able to guide our students. Then downtown, we have the director of exceptional education,
That's where the program is downtown. Somebody need to monitor that. We do not have anybody probably in accepted education monitor anything because we have compliance specialists in all the schools. And she's supposed to be working with the exception education students. And if they act up, they can go to the compliance specialist and talk with her, and she's supposed to be able to find out how to deal with these kids. Now, with the superintendent, if the new superintendent comes in, in fact, every superintendent that we had, basically not all, seemed like exception education is a hard department for them to deal with. So maybe they need to take a course or maybe go in staff development themselves with exception education to know the guidelines for handling our students. I know it's not fair for to suspend those students because when you look in the IEPs, it says Johnny will fight. It describes everything about that kid, and the teacher should know that. So those children should not be suspended. Regulations.
You stand there for, well, stay up there for the next question. I think you've answered the question. The next question will be a short yes or no answer. Most people use a school board as a starting place for political career. Many folks start off at the school board and then they move on to the city council, the house delegates, or state senate, wherever they move to. Will you pledge to serve your entire 4 years if you'd like to sit on the school board?
Yes.
Okay. So,
yes, I would pledge to sit the full 4 years, and I would pledge to run again. I don't believe that the issues at hand are something that can be addressed in a single term.
Thank you. Cindy?
Yes, I do pledge to serve the full term.
That was an easy question, wasn't it? But it's a very important question. You really have to think about that and ask for a board. Next question. What is the most urgent, pressing problem you feel that is facing RPS? If you had to say one thing, what would that one problem be that's currently facing RPS, the most urgent problem? And let's start with you, King.
I believe that the most pressing issue that's facing our school system is poverty. And so, you know, but with that, there's all these other parts and pieces to it. We've got segregated schools. We've got schools that have, it's like 40% of our students live in poverty. We have a reality where all of the schools are not the same because we've got segregated neighborhoods. But by and large, I would say that the biggest issue at this point is poverty.
And how would you address that issue?
Well, I wish I could. there's no, how can I solve the issue of poverty on the school board? I mean, I can't.
Let me rephrase that question. You know, many of us have heard that if you come from a certain zip code, that you can't learn. And many of us came from those kinds of zip codes and we did just fine. I've worked with people who went to one-room schools and became CEOs of corporations. So the question I guess for you would be, given that we know we have a poverty situation in Richmond, 26% overall and probably approaching 50% of the Afro-American community. First of all, is that an excuse for the children not to learn?
You know, it's not an excuse, but it's a reality, right? And so the best thing that we can do is try try to reach every kid where they're at and get those programs in place and put the accommodations in place and get the teachers in place to be able to reach each kid. But like I said, I don't believe that, the system that we have for measurement is, I believe it is lacking. I don't think that we're going to be able to, that multiple choice tests tell the reality of what's going on. We have this memorandum of understanding of the state, right? So now the state's trying to help us fix the schools. What I think they can do to help us fix the schools is to desegregate them. We're looking for a solution to do everything that we can to avoid desegregating the schools. We need to do that beyond the county lines, and it's a pipe dream, but that is the reality as I see it. In the meantime, we just need to get the dollars in place to be able to do what we need to do. Nobody wants to hear that it's going to take more money, but I believe that money matters. There's research out there that shows that when you put more money into a high poverty school, that it does make a difference. And it may not make a difference in terms of test scores, but when you look at life outcomes, when you look at unemployment levels, when you look at salary, average salary, even a 10% increase in funding can make a difference. But I wish I could fix the poverty too.
Thank you, Jamie. Jamie, would you like to go next? The one single thing for you that's the most pressing problem with RPS, and how would you go about fixing it?
The most pressing problem with Richard P.S. and the state of Nevada, ensuring safe environment for our students.
Can everybody with Joanne say it? Joanne, speak up.
Pressing is Richard Public Schools said that they provide a nurturing and safe environment for our students, as well as reading. They want them to read, write, and do math, and become employable when they graduate from high school and go to college. That's the most pressing thing that I see for our students, is regardless of whether we have the buildings, brand new buildings right there, we can't wait for that. The main pressing problem, our students need to be productive, employable, go to college, get a career, be able to read, write, do math. That's the pressing problem with our school district right now.
Okay, Joan, how would you recommend fixing it on the school board at Brooklyn Third District?
How we recommend fixing it? When we bring in our new superintendent, he is going to be able to know about education, be able to help the school board educate our kids by putting in programs that we know will work and move forward with the future with technology, new curriculums to help our kids be able to read, write, and learn.
So you say go back to the 3 hours, what you're saying?
Yes, exactly. We cannot do anything if we don't know how to read, if we can't do basic math. Those are the things we have to do, people. All the kids who are dropping out again, you have to look at data. Data is very important. Go pull it out and you will see how many kids cannot reach. You can see that by the SOL scores. As well as if you go to a school and say, let me look at your data for ninth graders. You have over ninth graders, they can't read. We have kids in elementary school, they pretend that they're learning how to read. By the time they get to middle school and get to high school, they can't read. So again, they need to know the basic reading, math, and writing, all that kids do in order to be able to get a job, a career, or go to college.
Thank you, Dr. Same question?
I think our most pressing issue across the district is talent, is recruiting the best principals and teachers to our district, is supporting them effectively, providing professional development, and that is ensuring that we keep them here. And the way that I would do that is again, prioritizing talent as one of the most important things that we do as a district. I would think about how we're creating a pipeline to bring in good principals and teachers.
And I would work hard to ensure that we're adjusting salaries to be able to recruit the best people here, and then doing all that we can to keep them in our system. Ultimately, if we've got the right people in place in all of our buildings, all kids can learn, and if we've got the right people there, then our kids are gonna do better. So that's where I would focus.
There has been much discussion about the impact of trauma on students' learning. What specific strategies would you implement to help address the issue of trauma outside of providing training or training of teachers? So other than training the teachers, what strategy would you have for dealing with our students who come to school with trauma?
So I think we need to address the root causes of trauma that our kids are experiencing. And I think this goes to what Kenny was talking about around poverty in our city. And I think we aren't gonna be able to effectively support kids in school buildings without coming together as a full city to really think about how we're supporting families out of poverty more holistically. And I think that means that we need folks in housing, we need folks in workforce development, we need across the board to be thinking about providing ways for families to truly become not just stable, but mobile, to be able to effectively deal with trauma in our schools. There are trauma situations that require interventions around counseling and therapy. Things like kids that are experiencing shootings are just happening far, far too often. But there are the more ubiquitous forms of trauma that exist. And so kids that don't know where they're gonna sleep, kids that don't know where their next meal is coming from, I think those are the things that we need to be addressing more consistently across the city by focusing on how we're ensuring that families have jobs that pay wages that will support them. And ultimately, that's a thing that the city needs to come together with. Education system's not going to solve that alone.
Fair point.
I don't know that I have a solution on how to address something as large as trauma. I do think that the value of integrated diverse schools, especially those that are socioeconomically diverse, right, is that we don't have classrooms with such a high concentration of kids where there's so many kids that are impacted by trauma in one room. I don't really know the possibility, right, of teachers being superstars, regardless of the training that they get, to be able to thrive in an environment with so many children having such high needs. That said, I do think that that methodology or in the climate, the educational climate that we're in right now, where so much focus is on testing, that what we lost is the opportunity to have the space for just allowing kids to build relationships, right? I mean, we're not just training kids to be able to fill in bubbles. We're training them to become adults and become people. And I think that we need to have a curriculum and the space to allow that type of exploration to happen without that high stakes pressure, right? I mean, we're kind of taking a high pressure situation and then we're putting more pressure on top of it. So teachers who are are in a room with kids that have this high level of need, and then the teachers are held up through this microscope to be able to get this artificial benchmark, and I think it just adds more pressure to the system.
Okay, thank you. Joanne?
Again, as an educator, I've seen it all, and trauma, or whatever you want to call it, is, again, compassion. You have to love and dedication. There are a lot of services out here in the communities for these our parents and our children, but when they come to our school, which is home for 8 hours, they need to have, as soon as they come to the door, they need love. They need that nurturing that we know that we can give them. And if they got that and we're consistent with that while they're in our environment, they will be comfortable. That's the only kind of way I can see how we can deal with this trauma, because our kids want to be loved and our teachers love our children. When they go home, it's a different story, and I'm sorry, unfortunately, but the parents love their children too. They don't know how to sometimes give it. And I work with adults at my school, and I see that they want their children to learn, and I see all the heartaches that they are going through, as well as their children. And yes, they got the services. Richmond Public Schools provide them with services. I think Richmond Public Schools has community and schools that is supposed to be helping provide our children with the same services that they're getting outside. So we're duplicating a lot of programs.
Dr. Chin, please stay there for the next question. What initiative programs would you advocate to make sure that students who drop out of RPS are still successful, for example, getting the GED met or vocational certification?
Well, first of all, they didn't come to Dream Academy.
Tell them what Dream Academy is.
I have an adult high school. You can be age 18 all the way up to 100 if you live that long. You can get a high school diploma instead of your GED. Last year we worked with a program called Success by 25, the Workforce Center. We graduated 25 students, found them jobs. Some went to college, some went to military. They're all over the place. So when they drop out, there are programs for them, but Dream Academy is the best place for them. We have a good curriculum. It's in line with the SOLs required by the State Department of Education. And there are lots of programs. The Workforce Center has a program for 16 to 24-year-old students that they can go and get a career. They pay for it, and they get a lot of training as well, and they pay for their education. We also offer medical billing and coding, pharmacy tech, phlebotomy and EKG at our school. So, in fact, I have a lot of John Marshall, a little bit of Thomas Jefferson, a lot of Armstrong, my kids, coming to Dream Academy. So that's one thing that they can do when they drop out. Come see me, and you can tell them about me. But there are other programs in the school district as well. But if we, the Richmond Technical Center over there, those kids, there shouldn't be any dropouts, basically, just a few. Because the tech center should be, even if they get ready to drop out, they should be able to, if they dropped out in the 9th or 12th grade and go over to the tech center, they should be certified in something, CNA, medical billing coding, all of that. Because in other school districts, at their centers, those kids have a license to go out and to be CNAs, medical billing coding, whatever they need. When they graduate from high school, even if they drop out, some of the kids tell me, well, I got my license, I'm certified to the state board, so I can do this, I can do that. So we got to build up our tech center as well, so even though our kids do drop out, they will have certifications.
Thank you. And the second part of that question, she didn't answer, but the second part of that question is, you're on the school board now. Third district, you went in November, so you were on the school board. How would you advocate to get some of those things in Richmond Public Schools to assist with kids who have that issue? So if they did drop out, they at least have some training more. Maybe they might not drop out because they.
I mean, that's what I'd start with, is saying we want to prevent kids from dropping out.
I think we, as a system, could do a better job of driving kids toward careers, so that if college is not the thing that a kid wants to do, that we are helping them figure out the many, many other options that exist for them. A fabulous career center that is could be even better utilized. And I think we could think about how we structure our high schools in a way that is actually allowing for kids to start thinking about the careers as they go into high school. And so instead of having so many comprehensive schools, we could have a system of specialty schools where kids could say, I want to study technical, I want to do STEM work, and so they go to a STEM school, or they want to do arts and theater, and so they go to an arts and theater school, or they want to be on a track for construction, and we make sure that they get on that track. I think we can start kids in their interests earlier, which will help engage them. One of the things that I think is really remarkable about the technical school is that they have very low incidence of discipline problems. But it's the same kids that go to all of the other schools in Richmond Public Schools. And I think part of the reason for that is, one, kids choose to go there, and two, they're doing really interesting, integrated, engaging work. And so I think if we could set all of our high schools up in that way, kids are able to choose paths a little bit earlier that keeps them engaged. We then keep kids in school and on a path for career or college, depending on which is the best for them.
Thank you, Sandy.
So I think this question has a right answer, and the right answer is that we want to have fewer dropouts to begin with. And I agree with Cindy and Joanne talking about that. I do think that there's room for improvement with our technical center. The program right now is part-time. I think that, I don't know that it's widely promoted within the school system. I believe that there's a lot of that's somewhat obsolete. So there's a ways to go. I think that what I've read and what I understand is that there's been some discussion about getting a dedicated building to make it a standalone full-time school, and I would support that effort. But I do think what we need to do to have more dropouts, and there's obviously lots of things. I know John Marshall, there was a great place for a woman who's done really great work to increase the graduation rate of that school. But I also believe that by improving programs in arts, vocational, there's a way to reach every kid. Not all of us are necessarily meant to go to college. Not everyone is going to pursue something academic. I'm came from a family of artists, and studying fine art myself as an undergrad, and I do believe that if we can find a way so that every kid can find their passion, whatever that is, then we increase our likelihood of allowing them to feel confident as they take that final step.
Thank you, Jimmy. Can Sandy go to the next question? In Reco County, they put in a meals tax to help fund public education, and specifically, the meals tax was used for facilities to keep the schools up. Would you support a tax on cigarettes to be used in designated school tax to bring more funding for the schools, for example, for more facilities in the schools?
I'm going to take the money wherever I can get the money. We need the money. The challenge with the cigarette tax. I mean, I would love to not have people smoke cigarettes, and so if we were to put a cigarette tax in place, I would hope that it would encourage people to smoke less. But I know that the folks that are smoking are largely those that. That don't have a lot of money, and I hate to shoulder people with spending more money on a habit they wish they didn't have. So if I was elected, I would look at all the opportunities to increase revenue for the schools, whether that be increasing the meals tax, looking at the property tax. I I want to get the money from the schools. I feel like there's the opportunity to do it. I also think we have to look at how putting a policy in place, and again, this is city council, this isn't the school board, but you know, I think we should look at a policy that would address how we're moving forward with surplus spending or surplus funds that the city has. This year we put in, we had a surplus of $13 million and it ended up going back into the rainy day budget. And I believe that our rainy day budget is now over where it needs to be. And I think that it's raining when you think about the facility. So yes, I think we need to look at at where we're getting additional revenue. I would consider a considering tax or propose that to the city council. But really, I'll take the money wherever we can get it. I'd love for us all to go marching to the state and look at the funding formula, because I think that there's a lot of shortfalls there. Again, that's not my job as a school board, but I think we need to advocate together, find those other districts in the city or in the state that are in similar situations so that we can to get that funds.
Thank you, Jamie. Joy,
I'm for raising the taxes on cigarettes. Yes, I am. And I would like those taxes to be so high my husband would stop smoking.
Dang.
Another question.
That's a great answer.
I would be all for a cigarette tax. I think the complication with the cigarette tax is that people will drive across the county line to buy their cigarettes, and that could hurt business owners in the city. So I think we should coordinate with the counties and have a cigarette tax that is across the state. I think ultimately, I think Kenyon hit the nail on the head with we need to advocate for the state to redo the funding formula for Richmond across Virginia. And though that is not within our jurisdiction as school board members, I think we can advocate for that with our state legislators and keep pushing that. And I think part of that is that we get out and vote and ensure that we turn this state blue, because I think ultimately that's what's going to happen if we do. So I think state formula needs to be redone. A cigarette tax would be great, but I think we need to look at bigger options for getting funding for Richmond Public Schools.
Thanks. This will be the last question that we ask, and then we'll go into our closing statement. Joanne, I'd like to go first and listen to you without the hand. Because we know the Department of Correction uses third-grade reading scores to determine funding for prisons and the Department of Corrections to do its long-term planning, why don't we focus more money and energy on ensuring that our children can read to target by third grade? Now, you spoke a little bit about reading. What are some of the things that if you were on the school board, you would advocate for with the superintendent and administration that they do to ensure that our children are reading by the time they're at third grade level, they're reading on grade level, or they don't get promoted?
Okay. First of all, we have, there are different programs for reading in Richmond Public Schools. Even though Richmond Public Schools has a budget for instruction, and Title I has money for Title I schools, and most of our schools are Title I schools, we have money for reading programs. So we need to implement some of those programs that we have for our kids to be able to read by the time they get to third grade. Is that what you said?
Yes, ma'am.
But for some reason, when you look at the SOL scores or either look at the elementary schools, they're saying that these kids can read. I don't understand why they're saying that. And when you look at the scores, it's showing that they can read.
They can read.
They can.
Yes.
70% of the kids can read.
Oh, they can read. Okay.
Yes. Uh-huh. And then another 30% cannot read. And that, again, it goes back to overage kids. But how are our kids going to read
with one teacher teaching reading to 20 kids. All 20 kids do not learn how to read at the same time. We learn
with the same methods.
So what we have to do is, and I believe in phonics, I don't believe in that sight reading. We need to put phonics back into the schools. We need to start teaching our little bitty children. I think preschool is 3 years old when they start. They have to know their colors. But now, kids are learning how to read now at 2 years old and older. I was in some preschools this summer, and our little kids, they were reading. They were calling out sounds. They're counting. They're coloring. They're doing gardening, and they're doing things with the STEM thing. So it's about the program that we're going to have to, when we get our new superintendent, he's going to know all this stuff. He's going to know that Richmond Public Schools has a problem with reading, our students learning how to read. So what we got to do is bring back phonics to our teachers, because yeah. The sight reading is definitely not helping our students. What was the other question?
That's it. Thank you, Dr. Okay.
I think that I agree that I appreciate a phonics approach to reading, and specifically a multi-sensory approach to reading. That is a huge benefit to my son. I think it's worth noting, right? So as my son. Whatever, too much information, but because he struggled with reading, right? I mean, as a parent, you can tell right away, right, when something's not right. And I'll tell you, you know, you're really an annoying parent when you go in there and you're like, you know, I'm telling you, there's something wrong. My daughter was at this point, my son's not, like, what gives? And then they say, but every kid is different. And you're like, yeah, I know, but still. Here's the truth, right? What they tell you is that, they typically don't identify dyslexia or some other thing, right, until the third grade. But there are, you know, identifiers to being able to identify that sooner. So if we know that, you know, 20% of kids might have some type of dyslexia or similar a similar issue, right, and we're essentially ignoring it, right? You're telling the parent, no, you're fine, everybody's on level until the third grade, you know, we're missing the mark. So I do think that, you know, how we're putting those remediations in place before the third grade is very important. Putting in a multi-sensory approach to reading that, again, benefits not just kids with special needs, but every kid, I think is an important thing to do. And listening to parents, right? I mean, if a parent believes that there's something going on, typically mama knows what she's talking about.
Okay, great. Second?
I think I would start with advocating for really ensuring that we are providing strong early education supports. Reading starts when kids are born, and the number of words that they hear, the number of books that are in the home, and being able to start a quality or early childhood education. And so I think that I would focus on how we are doing this work with the Children's Cabinet under the compact, the Education Compact, to say, what are the comprehensive services that we're providing that are starting with early education so that kids are getting into school more prepared for learning to read. I would support a lot of things that my colleagues have raised, that we need to be doing early intervention programs when we start seeing that things are not clicking the way that they should be. And then I think we could be adding in some innovative ways that reading is supported. So encouraging volunteers to come in and be reading with kids starting in preschool and kindergarten, so that kids are, again, getting a chance to read more books, hear more words. The things that we know are the early starts to building blocks for kids to be learning to read on time.
Thanks. Let me just say, I don't want to get to everybody's question. We're pretty much run out of time, but let's just take a second before we have to go to the closing statements and give these young ladies a big hand. Big warm hands. A really good question here. We can start with the closing statements, and if you go first, Joanne.
Say 22,000 enrollment right now are from first grade to 12th grade. That's where the enrollment. But we, I think that we can, we are going to do good and we're going to do better once we get our new superintendent, a good leader who believes in our students, who has a relation, who will have a relationship with all of his employees in Richmond Public Schools, because we want morale. We want this man to come in and motivate us and tell us we can do it, pump us up. So when he does that, when he goes out into those schools, he sees those kids engaged and learning, because the principal is a leader and he's motivating people. He's welcoming our parents into the schools. And that's one of the things that we don't have there. Parents coming to our schools, they see the front office first, they're looking all mad and what are we doing here? I mean, that's a turnoff. We need to motivate everyone, welcome our parents into our schools, welcome our stakeholders, our partners, and let everyone who would like to participate in helping make our children better students, help them to learn. Richmond Public Schools will excel, and it doesn't take 5 years to do it. It can take 1 year. It would take a few weeks. If you walk into Armstrong, my school, with the new principal who knows how to run a school, you're going to be excited about Armstrong when you walk through that door. You're going to feel the learning. That's what I want to see in Richmond Public Schools. I know we can do it. We have the resources to do it. Our teachers are great teachers. They know how to teach. They've gone through a whole lot of staff development even before they started teaching September the 6th. They were in more staff developments in 2 weeks than some people going a whole year. Our principals need to go into staff development so they can get motivated, so they can know how to operate the whole school, not just part of the school. So people tonight here, believe me, Richmond Public Schools may have a bad image. That's okay. We're getting a new superintendent who's going to turn things around, along with his staff, along with the principals and the teachers, and the parents are going to be inviting when they welcome, when they go into the schools. You're going to see good things with our school, and I believe it. And our board is not a bad board. They want to make sure that our kids are learning as well, and they're doing everything they can to help make that possible. And all I want to do on the third board is just, in the third district, is just to be on that board to help make decisions that I know that our kids will look, be going towards, focus towards becoming excellent. Our schools can become that. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr.
I believe that all kids can learn, and I feel really passionate about ensuring equity across Richmond Public Schools. Since I joined the board at the end of March, I've had the opportunity to work on a few different things. One of them is that I helped secure a partnership with Sprint to bring 5,000 free and connected tablets for Richmond Public Schools. I've been a part of helping to move forward the Education Compact, which was recently adopted by the City Council and the School Board unanimously, which will help ensure collaboration between our city government, put together a children's cabinet to support kids with more comprehensive services.
And I'm leading the work on our facilities to hopefully get a plan approved soon and financed. I want to be able to continue the work that I started on the board. Again, I think I bring a lot of experience having worked in infant poverty work and in many, many schools in New York City. I also feel very passionate about this work because I have two little ones, one of whom just started school in Richmond Public Schools. So I hope that you will consider supporting me in November. Thank you all for listening tonight. I know it's been a lot of conversation, but I appreciate the questions that you're asking and really look forward to working together with you all, whether I'm on the board or as a citizen of the 3rd District to improve Richmond Public Schools.
Thank you, Cindy. Cindy, that's early.
So again, my name is Kenya, and first and foremost, I'm an advocate. I've advocated for my kids, and I've advocated for every kid. And over the past few years in the city, my passion, my work has been working with other advocates in the city to get additional funding for our schools. And so I'm really proud of the work that we did. I'm proud of the fact that that effort led to a two-year decompression for teachers, right? So we talk about retention, and the fact of the matter is you have teachers at 9 years experience in the same pay scale as a teacher with 1 year experience. It's not surprising to me that we were seeing teachers. So I'm proud of that work. I'm proud of the fact that we made the issue of our facilities something that that there's been more awareness of, and we were able to secure additional funding in last year's budget because of that work. I don't believe that a superintendent is going to be the thing that's going to change the trajectory of our school system. I think the thing that's going to change the trajectory of our school system that I'd like to be a part of is really how we all work together. I think it's the people in this room, the people in the other rooms that are in other forums. We're the ones that are really driving the conversation. And I'd like to see us begin to talk to each other, break open our silos. So what I'm getting at is, the NAACP, the Democratic Committee, this group of folks here, the Crusades, the PTA, support our schools. We've all been working individually, and we're not talking to each other. And so I would like to see what we as a community can do to begin to break those silos, to listen to each other, and so that we can move forward as a group, right? Because I think that sometimes we hold ourselves back. So as a person on the board, I'd like to be the person to encourage those conversations. And so rather than guess at what a colleague might be motivating them to vote a certain way, I want to find out, right? Because we all have our reasons and we all have our motivations and we all want the very same thing. And so I'd like to see us change the dialogue that folks like to read when they're in the counties. They want to hear us fail. It makes them feel better. But I believe that our strength is in this room, and I'm excited about what's ahead.
Thank you, Kenny. Let's give Kenny a gift to the baby. Okay, thank everybody for listening to this session of the forum. And what I'd ask, do y'all ladies all have your literature? We're going to transition to the sheriff's forum. If you have your literature, feel free to give it out while the transition is being made. Let's give everybody a big hand again, please.
All right, this was the forum for the 3rd District School Board candidates coming up shortly.
Please stay seated if you would while we transition to the sheriff candidates.
What's about to take place in a moment is the candidates for the Richmond.
Everyone can remain seated and you know, look on your tables and see if you have index cards that you haven't used or don't plan on using, if you can kind of wave them so we can circulate them around the room, should anyone have questions for our sheriff candidates.
Yeah, it coming up.
We're going to move right into the sheriff's forum.
Yeah, coming up in a moment, it will be the candidates for Richmond City Sheriff. As you can see up there, there is Antoinette Irving. I had to move over the camera for a moment. And there's another candidate, and there is candidate number three right there. I don't know either of those two. I just know who Antoinette Irving is. And this is going to be their candidate form. It's about to take place in a few short moments. Our forum is on Wednesday.
We're going to go ahead and get started now with their forum for the sheriff candidates. And the forum will be exactly the same as the format will be exactly the same as it was for the school board candidates. We're going to have a 3-minute opening statement. There will be questions that will go to our sheriff candidates. They'll have 2 minutes to answer the question. If you take a little longer, that's fine. Not much longer, a little longer. And then we'll have a 2-minute closing statement. If you don't have an index card and you'd like to get one to ask a question, please see Bernice or Mamie Taylor or Albertina. They're around, they'll give you a card. We're going to start off. Now, this end of the table, Emma, do you want to go ahead and open the statement?
Yes, sir. Good evening, how are you doing?
Good evening.
Good to be here. I want to take one little moment to just pause for the those we lost 16 years ago in the 1990s. We still deal with a lot of terror and what have you. I didn't want that moment to just go by. A lot of lives, first responders and everybody else that went down in there. Okay, my name is Emmett Jafari. I started out in the field of corrections back in the mid-70s. If anybody would have told me that I would have been able to achieve what I had over the years, which really gave me what I consider to be the insight into this, being able to do this particular job. A lot of people mistake it and think it's law enforcement. It's not law enforcement, it's about corrections. And it is also about multi-site, because that's what it is. When you work at the city jail, I think that as candidates, we like to throw words around, obviously, because the vast majority of us, we're politicians, come out when there's an election. And one of the biggest words that we like to use is experience. Truth be told, there is no candidate running for sheriff who has experience as a sheriff. To be a deputy sheriff is a commendable, laudable job, but that's one aspect of corrections. And so what I want to do, I want to try to bring to this job an oversight that I have gathered not just from various correctional sites, but also from public venues and also from public schools. Because the sheriff's job is not just involved dealing with offenders, they also deal with the public. They interact with corporations when they do process and service. And so I don't want to narrow down to just thinking that it only entails working with offenders. And so I think I am, as far as I know, I'm not aware of all the detailed experience, quote unquote, of the other candidates. But as for myself, I can tell you that I've come up over the years through multiple sites, and that's what I plan to bring to this particular room. Thank you.
Thank you,
Emma. Nicole? Good evening, everyone. First, I want to thank the State Voters for having this forum for us to be able to give out
platforms
so that everyone can hear
what
we have to offer.
Thank you.
I am Nicole Jackson, independent candidate running for sheriff in the city of Richmond. I was born in South Boston, Virginia. My family moved here when I was 7 years old. And when we moved here, I attended Richmond Public Schools. I attended Chimborazo Elementary School, then also attended East End Middle School. And then when I got into high school, my parents moved to Henrico County, where I graduated from Verona High School. Immediately graduating high school, I enlisted in the military, in the United States Army, and I enlisted for 3 years. And once my enlistment was completed, I returned back to Richmond, Virginia, where I enlisted in Virginia National Guard here in Sandston. Right after that, I started my law enforcement career. I worked for the Richmond Police Department for 9 years. And while working there, I served in various departments, worked patrol operations over by 3rd Precinct. If you all can recall the 3rd Precinct, I think it's now in Sectors, but that's on Meadow Street. Also worked in community intelligence as a community intelligence detective, working directly under Jerry Oliver when he was here. And I also worked in the training division for 5 years. Also in that division, we trained new police officers, police recruits to become police officers. We also were successful in completing over hundreds of citizens academies. Right after that, I was employed with the Richmond Sheriff's Department. I've been employed with the Richmond Sheriff's Department. I worked there for approximately 13 years. And I've also worked various positions at the Sheriff's Office. Classification was one of my assignments, record room, jail operations, civil processing supervisor, courthouse commander. And upon my leaving the Richmond Sheriff's Office, I left as a major. I went through the ranks and left as a major. In addition to that, while working at the police department, I didn't want to leave this part out. While working full-time, I also took on a part-time job with the Richmond City Public Schools as a substitute teacher. And I've also obtained my bachelor's degree in accounting from Strayer University. So I'm here because of my background and my experience in law enforcement and what I have to bring to the table. And I'm also passionate about what we're doing in Richmond. And I can see from where I've been that citizens could use my expertise in the Richmond Sheriff's Department. Thank you.
Thank you, Nicole.
Okay.
Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
My name is Antoinette Urban, and I'm the Democratic nominee for sheriff here in the city of Richmond. And I bring to you, as the citizens of Richmond, the experience of having over 26 years in the Henrico Sheriff's Office, where I either work, supervise, manager, and administrator in every section in the Sheriff's Office. I retired from the Sheriff's Office on January 1st, 2015, as the facility administrator with the rank of major. Since that time, I'm not going to go through my entire background, but since that time, I've obtained my doctoral degree in criminal justice management from North Central University, so that gives you an idea of the different types of educational background that I have. But I've worked at the Sheriff's Office making sure that we had different types of programs for our individuals that were incarcerated to ensure that they could re-enter the society and make sure that they had the things that they needed in order to become better citizens. And I want to continue to bring that to the citizens of Richmond. Yes, I worked in Henrico for over 26 years, but it's about the community. It's about the individuals that live and work and play in our particular city. So I want to make sure that I can bring that to the Richmond Sheriff's Office. As Mr. Jafari said, it's not just about offenders or individuals that are incarcerated, it's about everyone. It's about our young people, it's about our senior citizens, it's about our community as a whole, because it starts with how it is we can put those connectors together to make sure that individuals can become better. So it's our responsibility, the Sheriff's Office, to make sure that we do our part, because it's going to take all of us to make sure that we have a good Richmond. One Richmond, one city, to make sure that we can build on each other and build relationships with one another. So I ask on November the 7th that I get your vote for the next sheriff here in the city of Richmond.
Thank you. So we got questions now. Emma, keep going first. We're going to rotate around each time. You want the first member question?
You got a question for me? Or?
Yeah, I've got a question for all three candidates. Okay. We're about to get the same question. Okay. So, I mean, the first question, and again, this will be the same question for all three candidates.
What alternatives to incarceration program would you like to see implemented and why?
Okay, there's two ways to approach this. One is pre-adjudication and the other is post-adjudication. Unfortunately, we've had changes in grant funding. When I worked for County Boosting, that was a part of our job. I did court support services, and a part of that was coming up with alternatives to incarceration. They tremendously impacted that by not continuing a lot of the grants. Now, there are two other ways inside. There's one other way inside to keep them from coming back, and that's a refocus. It's not as simple to refocus an offender's mindset. But what you have to do is start with training your staff. Everybody has to be on one accord. You know, we're not here. Some of the jobs I've taken, when I took the job, I'd go in and they were talking to the offenders and around the offenders about what happened at the club, this kind of stuff. And if you're not careful, you don't stay alert, this kind of behavior can slip out. So what I want to do, first of all, I want to focus and make sure all of my staff are staying focused on why they're there. You can talk about the other things when you leave. The other piece of it is some vocation. I want to focus on vocations, what you can do with your own hands. I'm a metal worker, I'm a welder by trade. And so even when you're unemployed for working for somebody else, you can continue to work for yourself. So I want to lift their sights so that they understand that the imminent power that they have in themselves to remain employed and gainfully employed and have self-respect lies with them. And of course, the other little piece is after you're released, and that is community services that you can do in terms of sentencing people to long sentences. Those are basically the three types of things that I would look at.
Thank you, Andy.
Sir.
Cole?
Prevent individuals from being incarcerated would be partnerships. And partnerships across the board, partnership with the Sheriff's Department along with, let's say, Richmond Public Schools. And when we talk about Richmond Public Schools, we want to capture those youth that are just getting into middle school. That's when they get to the point where they're starting to go left or they're starting to go right. So we need a partnership with Richmond Public Schools to capture those youth. Find programs that would be appropriate for them to give them something to do with their time, like youth programs, skill building programs, recreational programs, and also to include their family members to be a part of those programs. I think that if we can capture them before they start getting into trouble, that would help eliminate some individuals coming into jail. Another thing I would see working is creating the Richmond Police Department partnering with the Sheriff's Department and creating a task force from the Sheriff's Department that can be attached to the Richmond Police Department so that we can join forces with them, so that we can control neighborhoods, so that we can be more visible as a law enforcement community. I think that right now, you know, we don't have enough police officers. Right now. If the Sheriff's Department can get involved with partnership and with the police department, and utilizing the resources that we have at the jail, like those vehicles that we have that are fully equipped to patrol. They have lights and sirens and all the things that you need to patrol. And it symbols, it has the symbols on them as far as the Sheriff's Department in identifying who they are. So we can utilize those vehicles and some of our resources of deputies to help in assisting with patrol duties within the city. That will help eliminate and deter crime from happening. Also, we can also look at partnering with RPD in regards to having our deputies trained, fully trained, and working with our Richmond Public Schools in the schools. Currently, the Richmond Police Department, police officers are in the schools as security right now. And the Sheriff's Department can alleviate them, have them go out on the street where they're most needed, and have the deputies work the schools as school security. One time before, and I actually was on this task force where the Sheriff's Department did work, deputies did work in the schools as school security, but it was done as an off-duty job where they were paid on the side. What I'm proposing is that the deputies work in the schools instead of the police office, and they receive the same pay that they would receive if they were working as a deputy. Those are some of the things that I think will help.
Thank you.
eliminating the police officers in the school, putting them back on the street where they're more visible and they're able to patrol and do some of the most other important things that need to be done in the city.
In talking about how it is that we can prevent some of the having alternatives to incarceration and as a prevent, whether they're before the incarceration or after the incarceration, it's a concept of ensuring that we have built relationships with our community. And within building those relationships with communities, whether it's educational, vocational, or it's nonprofit, religious, or for-profit businesses, we have to build those relationships so that our individuals in our community know that we actually care about them and try to grow them as individuals. And we can start with our young people. What I would like to do is have a Sheriff's Foundation where we can interact with our young people in the schools as well as in the communities and the different organizations that we currently have, so that we can build relationships with them so that they can understand how important they are and what their value is to the community and their value is to their homes and their families, so that they'll know that there are things out there for them other than just joining gangs or having some type of criminal behavior. As far as alternatives to incarceration for adults, if there's once individuals have committed an act and they have to go before the judicial system, we'd like to have a program where they don't have to be incarcerated, but we need to make sure that most of the people that are incarcerated have some type of illness or some type of drug addiction. So we want to make sure that we can send them through that avenue to make sure that they can get the proper treatment and the proper care, so that we're not just punishing people for an illness or an addiction that they have, but to ensure that they can get the proper treatment and the help so that they can understand why their behaviors are. Because there's a reason behind every behavior that anyone has. A lot of times they don't stop and think about that. I know that they do think more when they're incarcerated because they're sitting still. And they even though they have to watch their back maybe when they are incarcerated, but it's a point of they're sitting still and they're thinking about why is it that I'm doing things? What's going to happen to me next? But we have to make sure that we can put those programs together and send them to something that's going to build them as individuals and make sure that they can be properly treated for what's going on. The other part of that is, as we talked about the post, we want to make sure that individuals have the proper services that they need so that they won't continue to come back. Because if they're released and we've not given them an avenue to grow or build on themselves, they're going to continue to come back. So that means that we want to have high recidivism and the same crimes and the same people are going to be coming back and the same things are going to be happening in our communities. So we have to make sure that when they exit, they are already exiting with a plan. They're given an assessment when they come in to see what they, it's almost like a kid when you say, where do you want to be when you grow up? And we want to make sure that they have a plan of action. Teach them how to fill out job applications, how important it is to have an identification. Give them the tools necessary so they won't keep coming back because now they have value to themselves and to their families. So the alternative to incarceration is to build the individual to ensure that they have the proper tools and resources to become better individuals and not just expect them to do better because we say they can do better. If you don't know, they can only do what they have. So we have to make sure that they are properly prepared. Yes. And they're prepared in the communities through the nonprofits and through the different groups and organizations that we have. We can connect them to those resources before, and then if they do happen to be incarcerated, we can continue to connect them to those resources so they can have those avenues when they get out. So we have to look at what those alternatives are and how those alternatives can best fit each individual so that they can go back in the community and have a sustainable life.
Yeah.
Next question, we'd like to start with you, Monica. Many feel that employee morale at the city jail is at a low with a high turnover rate. What are your plans to improve employee morale and retain good employees?
No.
I will put in place a real true legitimate promotional process, ensuring that those that are applying for those positions, ensuring that they are qualified individuals, and they are capable of handling the job, and they are experienced in whatever it is that they are applying for. Also, I will create a committee, and what I will call a team building or morale building committee, that will consist of supervisors, deputies, and other administrators to put together a team that will focus and concentrate only on building morale within the department, whether it's creating recreational activities, creating functions for deputies to do as a team, whatever that may be, we will put together a team, a committee to address those issues. I also think that pay is also a concern for deputies as far as morale. Other agencies in the surrounding area do start out with a little bit more than what our Richmond deputies do. So we definitely need to address that in City Hall and the State Comp Board is something that I plan to do as well. I think that the deputies at this moment feel unappreciated and they don't feel valued. And part in that is because of leadership and some of the policies and procedures that they have in place currently that are not fair. So I plan to be fair in every decision that I make, and I want to ensure that the deputies understand that whatever it is that they're trying to do, that they will have the support of the administration. Thank you.
Thank you.
As far as the morale starts with leadership. Having a leader that individuals can trust and believe in, also a leader that can motivate individuals to do their job. It's not saying that you have to be soft on anybody, but it's saying that you have to build a relationship with individuals to ensure that they know that you are there for them, that you can do the job that they're being asked to do, that they can come in here and speak to you. I think it is fair, firm, and consistent. And they teach us that, and they preach that to us on a regular basis. We have to make sure that individuals are properly trained and get allowed to do the job that they're actually trained to do. Giving them the room to make the decisions that they've been trained to do. We have to do that as an agency and as a leadership. We have to do that as an administration. What we would like to do is ensure that there's a deputy advisory committee where the deputies from different sections are together and they can talk about the things that they are positive about and talk about the things that they have some concerns with, as well as some of the training that they feel that they need. Also have a supervisor advisory committee. And we've had those in Henrico, and they work because it gives you the opportunity to speak on your level with one another and bring those concerns to the administration to ensure that you're a part of what's going on in your agency. That helps with morale. And yes, the pay is a question because the pay is not evenly distributed in course of from line staff member to top administrator. It's not. So we have to make sure that individuals are paid properly around from the surrounding counties or the surrounding cities that they're incorporated with. But we have to make sure that individuals are actually paid what they're worth. Some people are down at the bottom and haven't gotten raises in years, and some people are way up here in the pay scale, and it's upsetting to people because people do their jobs, and they want to do a good job, and they want to represent their families well, and they work hard. And then there are some stumbling blocks or bumps that's in the road when it comes to certain people. We want to make sure that everybody is treated fairly. We want to make sure that the individuals that are working there are given the opportunity to be promoted in accordance to what their abilities are and what they're capable of. You have to be fair with individuals in order to motivate them. So making sure that they can do the job that they've been trained to do and given the opportunity to express themselves when things are not going the way that they feel it should. Yes, there are policies and procedures that will be in place, but if there are questions, the questions should be answered. So you have to work together as a team. It's about team building from bottom to top and top to bottom. You know, even though there's a sheriff that's in charge, the individuals working are responsible for a majority of everything that goes on in that agency. So we want to make sure that they know what to do and they're allowed to do that. And that's the start of the motivation that will bring that morale up and giving them the opportunity to grow. You promote it. We'll want to have educational incentives for them, whether our educational rank structure, so that they can be paid a little bit more for the other things that they do, and to use them for the skills that they actually have, and put people in positions that they can actually work. You know, just because I like you, the
sometimes that's not going to work. And we've had that in different agencies. I like you, so you work in certain places. No, you work in accordance to your qualifications and your capabilities.
Yes.
And that's what motivates other people when they see people in a position to do the job that they're supposed to be doing and not just doing the job because somebody wants them in that position. That's where morale starts to build and making sure that individuals have fair and equal opportunity to do their job and make sure that they can care for the individuals that live there. And they want to make sure that they can do that. People that work in the sheriff's office, they want to make sure that the individuals that are there, that they're taken care of because they're entrusted in our custody while they're there. And we want to help them to build to be better people. And if we are not allowed to do that, then that's where the problem's coming. So we want to make sure that everybody has the opportunity to do their job. That's where morale is right there.
Yes, indeed. Yes, indeed.
I agree.
Well, everybody fit that. That's spot on. In some of the assignments that I've had, and I've gone to, I've been assigned units where there was rancor and discord amongst the staff. Invariably, when I've looked into it, it's just what Antoinette and Nicole said. It's being treated unequally. Faves, if you will, being allowed to work more overtime. Sometimes you can't just give them pay.
Yeah.
But I have found consistently, if you treat each one of them with respect and dignity in that particular position and in that unit, they will pull together. Now, I would also say that in each of those situations, I was hired from the outside, and I still came in and made that difference. And so you have to be able to affect people. You have to be able to impact people with your fairness. You lead with the type of person that you are. First of all, they're going to see that. And you, even though it's not unusual in a job that you have some people that you depend on more so than others, you're doing this because of their resources, what they bring to you. But in the final analysis, when it comes down to who's going to get determined if there's a disciplinary issue, there's a grievance issue, if there's a pay issue, assignment issue, it has to be done equitably. It has to be done across the board. You simply can't reach out and just select a favorite to do something with. So I definitely agree with it. I'm not going to belabor that. You have to start with it, and you have to work with the staff from the inside out. Now, the last time I did this, I was working with GRTC, brought in from the outside, and I got those drivers, those operators to work together, and it got the GRTC their first national award in the whole history, over 100-year history of the unit, of the GRTC. So I know that it works. And I know it works because if you get in there and roll your sleeves up, you're going to get some rejection. You're going to get some cronyism. You're going to get people who are going to say other things or whatever. But if you work together as a unit, you can get it done. And I stand here as living proof that having worked in there, and it works.
All right.
Thank you, Evan.
Okay.
All right.
Fair enough.
The next question, if you could leave with that answer. And that is, outline your plans, the one or two major initiatives to assist inmates who have served their time and been released to be successful upon reentry into their community.
Oh, this is gonna be, good.
And working with individuals to ensure that they can be successful when they get out, it starts while they're there. And I like early assessment, again, so we know what it is that their skill set is, what it is that their medical and mental health issues may be, or what it is their addictions are. So we make a proper assessment to assure that they can build on that. So we want to make sure that we can help them with their life skills and their life search skills, job skills. So we want to make sure that we can do that from the time that they're there, working and building relationships with businesses, nonprofits, to ensure that they have the tools to work. We want to make sure that they can work, that their skills are being improved. If they have reading skill problems, math skill problems, if they just don't know what kind of job they want or what their skill set is, we want to work with them to get those skill sets up to the point where they're in a relationship with a company that they can work for to help the city with some of the job issues that they have in the city. We can work with the city in ensuring that individuals are trained in their skill set to ensure that they can work those jobs so that they will have built a relationship with the city or with whatever company it is so that they can go and work once they get out. We want to make sure that they can have a job. that they can work a job, and that they can keep a job, because we want them to be able to have a sustainable life with their families and make sure that they can be good role models. We want to make sure that if they have some type of medical or mental health issue, that we can connect them with the proper resources and tools while they're there so that they can continue to build and not wait until it's time for them to get out 30 days to 15 days prior to release, and then start to connect them with community resources or services that they may need, making sure that they have built those relationships and building trust. Because the majority of the individuals that are incarcerated have an issue with trust. So if I don't trust you, I'm not going to trust that you're going to help me get a job, that you're going to help me learn how to fill out a job application, get my driver's license, or get an ID if I can't drive, to help me figure out what things I need for my family. The other piece of that is we want to make sure that individuals have an opportunity to meet with their family members, to have those conversations as to how it is that we have been affected by what happens to them when they're incarcerated. So we want to make sure that inmates, residents, or clients, I know different people call them different, so we want to make sure that they have an opportunity to meet with their family members and have those conversations on a regular basis to build that family unit back up.
Yes,
because if they're not building that family while they're incarcerated, it's going to be a problem when they go back. So we want to make sure that the family member can say, because of your incarceration, these types of things have happened to our family, and what is it that we need to do together as a unit to rebuild our family? So we want to make sure that we do that, have a restorative justice system that they can use to build up the family, as well as making sure that we have programs and services in place from an initial assessment to make sure that they have resources available to them to build their job skills, to build their resources, to build their vocational and educational aptitude so that they can be able to be successful when they get out. Because our goal is to reduce recidivism, if not eliminate it. I know that's hard, but the goal is to quash that word recidivism and saying that, you know, Johnny's coming back, Lil Jojo or Pookie Man is coming back. As soon as he get out, because he's going to hang back on the same form. We want to make sure that they have enough value to themselves and feel well enough about themselves that they won't have to think about things that they used to do to survive. They now have value and feeling to themselves and to their family, so that they'll think about, this is what I need to do to build my family and my community and be a part of that to stop some of the foolishness that's going on in my community.
Yes, indeed.
Thank you.
All righty.
So,
I think it's very important that we address the issue of reentry and recidivism. It's a growing problem, not just in our community, but communities across the country. And, you know, I think that we as law enforcement or deputy sheriffs or sheriffs need to have a complete plan, a wraparound plan for individuals to prepare them for when they are released from jail. Some of the programs that the jail currently have, which is the REAL program, is a great program right now. They actually target those with drug addiction. And the program, actually, when they get out of the program, once they're released, they actually have a house where they can reside at until they can get on their feet. I think the REAL program is doing very well. We also have an educational TO currently at the Sheriff's Department, where people can get their GEDs, take classes, enroll in college courses, and take college courses. Also, what I would propose is what I call a 90-day success program, and that program is going to consist of four phases. In the initial phase, and this is where individuals have 90 days or less to serve in the jail. And the first phase will consist of self-exploration, meaning learning about self, learning about why they do what they do, learning about the deep-rooted issues that have caused them to commit the crimes that they've committed. I don't agree that every person in the jail has a mental health problem or, you know, mental health problems, as I think Antoinette stated. I think some people just going through a hard time sometimes. They make bad decisions, but it doesn't mean that they're drug addicted or that they have a mental issue. That's not always the case. So we want to address the underlying issues as to why they're committing the crimes that they're committing. There are plenty other addictions other than drug addiction that people have. The other state, the part with the phase one, the self-exploration, we also want to do some success coaching. We want to talk about conflict resolutions, stress management, character building, and we also want to get in some faith-based support in this first phase. The second phase will consist of preparation, preparing them to get ready to get out. Meaning we will start talking about and showing them how to write resumes, have a resume writing workshops, practicing interview technique skills, entrepreneurship workshops, how to fill out applications, how to register for classes online, having business owners actually come in. I've confirmed 3 business owners already that are willing to come in and talk to these guys about how they started their business and what it takes to be a business owner, and that they can be successful regardless of what their past experiences or circumstances have been. Also, we can have what we call craft and talents and skills. Let's look into what talents individuals have that's incarcerated. What skills do they already have? We can enhance on those in phase two. Phase three, we're talking about readiness. Now they're ready. They're ready to come out. They're ready to enter into society. But before they do that, they're going to get a visit from social services. Social services are going to come in and make sure that they have everything they need to have as far as when they get out. If it's Medicaid that they are eligible for, then they're going to make sure that they get that. We want to make sure that they have housing. We want to make sure that they have transportation. And we're going to also ask those business owners to come in and conduct interviews with these individuals, so that they can have the job lined up before they get out of jail. Also, we're gonna have probation come in and speak with them to make sure that we clear up any probation issues. Visit from DMV to make sure that they have the proper identification before they get out. The last phase is what I call the follow-up phase, consists of those individuals following up on everything that they've received before they left. So what I'm going to do is challenge the civic associations within the city to partnership with the sheriff's office in this endeavor. In other words, the individuals, when they get out, they need a resource to go to. We don't want to say, hey, we're going to give you all these skills and resources and then just go. We want them to have someone that they can go to as a resource if they're having issues. The civic associations can be the liaison between that individual and the sheriff's office program. That being said, we can partnership with other nonprofit organizations. We can partnership with mental health organizations, which one I've met a young lady today that's employed with what they call SEM, a support, empower, and motivate. That is a nonprofit organization that strictly deals with the mental health side of things. So if you have someone that has a mental health issue and they're getting ready to get released, then we need to make sure that we send that person to SEM. So we have that already lined up. And also, with the sense of doing this, we are creating an evidence-based tracking system. We can see how well this is going to work. And if this works well, then hey, we can pass this on to other agencies. So that's what I propose to do as far as individuals and when they get released from jail.
Thank you, Joe.
So all of these things are interactive. Working with them to form alliances, to make certain that when they do leave jail, they're going to have businesses that are willing, open, and receptive to having offenders. A lot of businesses may talk a good game, but they're really not sold on the idea of having offenders around their clients and their clientele. The other little piece of it is what I talked about a little earlier, and that's the training aspect. Training puts a focus on your staff. For them to know that we're focused on what we're doing here and we don't have time really for the other things. By the time you know it, the day is over and they've done their job. The other piece of it is post-release, which is what this question goes to. If you've done those first couple of pieces and you constantly got your people working on that, again, you're going to have to look at your staff. You may have some staff working in some positions who are better outreach people. And so you're going to have to jiggle them up. Maybe the person that was doing a good job or the cushy job, they may not like it. So not everybody's going to like it. But if everybody understands that this is a team effort and what we're after in the long run, and what we're after here is reduction in recidivism. And we talk about reducing recidivism, but the reality is we have recidivism. And we likely will always have it. But the question is, what can you do to release it? And those programs that you do while they're in jail and having set up something with employers once they leave jail and to also include trying to restructure and rebuild a lot of those family structures. They have totally broken those down. By the time they get to jail, they have worn their families out. Their families have dealt with them for many years. So you have to do this in phases, and you have to make certain that you have something for them to go out to, and that they have at least an improved self-confidence view about themselves when they go out into the world. And you only have that bit of time, that window, while they're in there with you.
Thank you. Our next question, and we'd like to start the next question with you, if you could. President Obama, an article in the Washington Post in 2016 said that we must rethink solitary confinement.
Ooh.
Do you believe it is cruel and unusual punishment? Yes or no? What, and then what does it look like in the city jail? Many of us really don't know what it looks like. We've seen it on TV, but what does solitary confinement really look like in the city jail?
I'm going to deal with the back end of that first. I've not been invited there to walk through the jail. And some of us have, but I've not been with that group, so I can't tell you what it looks like in this particular jail. But I can tell you that all jails have the same types of settings. They have secure settings, they have open bay settings, they have those types of things. Beyond that, it is in the discretion of the sheriff whether you get a mattress on the ceiling floor, or whether you get a mattress on the pillow, or whether you just get a pillow. Your question is yes or no?
Do you think it's cruel and unusual punishment, solitary confinement? And if you were elected, would you continue that in the city jail?
Now, I'm gonna tell you this, it's difficult for me to just answer that yes or no, because solitary confinement consists of multiple levels. I just described some to you. Sometimes you can just have a cement floor, depending on where they want to take this, right? And also depending on, I've talked to people who were in down at the Red Onion, and all they had was a hole in the floor, pitch black. So, you know, to qualify the statement, you know, you have to know, sometimes you just get that cement lump with that mattress on it, and you stand there in the dark. That's solitary confinement. It depends on the policies and procedures that the place has, that they have in effect. I've worked behind the wall, and there are times when you have to put a person alone. There are times when they are unsafe to themselves and to others. And we're not gonna leave out the punitive aspect of it, because some of what you do, there's a punishment and consequence for it. Now, in terms of putting somebody on some cement and just leaving them on the floor, yes, cruel and unusual, that's extreme. In terms of putting somebody away and having them monitored and checked in accordance with policy and procedures, on timely intervals, I really have a problem with that. That's a part of corrections, and I'm not gonna stand here and make it look like you can do away with that. You can't do that.
Thank you. Antoinette, would you like to go next?
Currently, I'm not aware of how that system is at the city jail. I neither have been there. I had a short little tour that didn't show any of those things, but that was when I went with the NAACP a couple of years or so ago. That's the only.
Well, speaking about your knowledge of
the interaction that I've had, as far as it's solitary or disciplinary confinement is a term that's been used. As he said, there are times when individuals are placed in cells to not harm themselves or harm anyone else. But I believe you guys are speaking of as a disciplinary process as far as solitary confinement, when there's a 23-in-1 where individuals are confined to their cell areas for 23 hours and they're allowed out to have recreation. There are times when individuals, your behavior has dictated whether or not you can live with other people, or you can interact with other people. What we've done in the past is that individuals may come out for an hour, they may come out for 15 minutes in different blocks. so that they can ensure that they have their exercise, that they have meals, that they have an opportunity to walk around, they have an opportunity to communicate with the staff members that are there, whether it's a officer, whether it's mental health, whether it's medical, whether it's religion. You know, they have an opportunity to speak with other people, even if they are confined for those amount of hours. Just to say that they're going to be locked down and not have any communication or any contact with anyone else, that's something that we want to make sure does not happen. And if they are confined for over a certain amount of period, we want to make sure that we have a staff member that's there with them, that's watching them for 15-minute intervals, if not 30-minute intervals. It depends on why they are placed in those situations. We want to make sure that they're actually watched, that they're communicating with. Because we want to make sure that individuals, even though there may be a disciplinary issue, that they're not placed in a position where they will harm themselves because they're thinking that they're seeing things or thinking that the walls are closing in on. You know, that's medical and mental, as well as disciplinary, as to why it is that our staff members would have to make sure that we are monitoring the activities of individuals. We don't want to ever put an individual in a situation where they will want to do harm to themselves, even though they may already want to do harm to themselves, but it's our responsibility to make sure that we can watch out and care for them. As far as it being cruel and unusual, we don't want to put anyone in that situation to have cruel and unusual punishment, because it's a disciplinary, we want to train a behavior that can be corrected to make sure that individuals can care for themselves and that we can also care for them.
Yes.
You work at the city. Why don't you start off by telling us what solitary confinement looks like?
Can you give me a question one more time?
Yes, ma'am. Former President Obama, in an article of the Washington Post in 2016, said that we must rethink solitary confinement. The question is, do you believe it is cruel and unusual punishment? Yes or no? The other part is, what does it look like in the city jail? Maybe you can start off with that first, what it looks like since you work in the city jail, what it looks like, and will you continue solitary confinement in Richmond City Jail if you're elected to the city sheriff?
Well, currently they have pods set up, and on each pod they have several what they call tiers, and that's where the individual is taken into when it's time to shut down. They go inside their tier in their pod. Well, where it's individuals that's by themselves or they locked down, they're actually by themselves. They have no other inmates around them at the time. To answer your question, I do believe that it is, cruel and inhumane. I do think that it is. I believe that. And I say that to say, if you're going to lock an individual down for whatever reason, whether it's disciplinary or medical, I still think that after so much time has passed, that they still need to have that interaction with individuals, because being locked in that cell by yourself for hours and hours and hours at a time, it starts to have an effect on your mind. And if they weren't crazy before they went there, they probably will be crazy when they come out. So I do believe that we should not continue solitary confinement. I think that we need to revamp how we do it if someone has to be locked down. I don't think that they should be locked down for an extended period of time without interacting with other human beings.
Thank you.
All right.
This is the last question from the moderator. Then we'll take some questions from the floor.
It's the whole point of this. That's exactly what she says. Exactly what.
And we'll start with you, Nicole, for the first question, for this last question. The Richmond Times Dispatch reported that taxpayers have spent more defending and settling lawsuits against the Richmond Sheriff's Office in the city jail since 2011 than any other sheriff in jail in the state. Over that 5-year period, the state has spent about $6 million resolving claims for wrongdoing against Richmond Jail and sheriff's office.
For example, in 2016, 6 inmates died while in the city jail. First, do you think this is reasonable and acceptable, given the population of the jail that includes the mentally ill and drug addiction?
No, I do not think that it's reasonable at all. When we had the old jail, people complained about overheat, exhaustion, that kind of, you know, it was old, you know, we got a new jail, and it seemed like we got more deaths after that. So I truly believe that the lack of security in the city jail right now is one of the main issues why we've had so many deaths. With that being said, the security, as far as when you come into the jail, and we have a lot of people that come into the jail, as far as contractors, faith based leaders, we have family members coming in, we have inmates leaving and coming throughout the day. We need to train our deputies to do proper searches of all individuals that enter into the jail, and also that enter into the courthouse. We also need to look into getting a full body x-ray machine of all inmates that are taken into custody. Currently, we do not have that at the city jail. So people are constantly bringing in contraband into the jail, and that's how drugs get into the jail. And then next thing you know, you have people overdosing. And I believe the overdosing was the cause of quite a few deaths from the jail. And I think that was in the paper. Also, we need to train our deputies in crisis intervention. Currently, they do not receive that training at all, not even in the academy. So I would propose that every deputy, certified deputy, they will receive crisis intervention training that will give them that experience and that hands-on knowledge of how to deal with people that may be resistant, people with mental illness, and that kind of thing. Also, reevaluate the medical contractor. Now, years ago, when I worked at the jail, we didn't have a medical contract, and we had deputies that were actually certified as medical personnel that worked in the medical department. So I would definitely say that we need to revisit that contracted medical company that we have. You know, when you're dealing with these inmates on a certain level, meaning on a medical professional level, it's not the same as dealing with them as if you were a law enforcement or a deputy. These individuals are civilians. They're not familiar with how to handle certain situations when they come up and regarding the inmates. So we need to look at reevaluating the medical contractor. We also need to look at medication management. While working at the courts, I constantly hear day in and day out inmates stating that they're not getting their medication, they're not getting their medication. That's a safety concern for me. That's a security concern for me. Because if they're not getting their medication, then we're gonna have a whole nother problem later on. Or if something happens to that person and they don't get their medication and they pass away, then we're looking at another lawsuit. So we definitely need to have medication management put in place and monitored constantly by medical professionals. Also, we have a lot of people incarcerated that cannot speak English or don't speak English very well. I would propose that we get in a certified translator to work in the classification department. So when individuals that come in cannot speak English, we have someone there that's certified to translate so that we can understand what they're saying. A lot of times assaults can go undocumented, sexual physical assaults can go undocumented. You know, when they need their medication, if we can't understand that they're saying they're in pain, then we have a problem. So we need to get a translator, a certified translator within the jail. Also, when we're talking about the mental health part, the governor put in place a mental health program initiative that was grant funded to, I think, 5 sheriff's offices in the state, and Richmond was one of them. And what happens is, initially when a person would come to jail, it would take weeks for that person to be evaluated for a mental illness. Well, now that that initiative has taken place, they have 24 hours to be evaluated for a mental illness. And if they are diagnosed, I would propose that we have a mentally ill tier just for those individuals that that's monitored by a certified personnel that's certified in mental illness and social services, and we can make sure that somebody is monitoring those individuals on a constant basis, and somebody that knows how to interact with them on that level. And I think that is all I have. Thank
you.
The Richmond Times-Dispatch reported that taxpayers have spent more defending and settling lawsuits against the Richmond Sheriff's Office and the city jail since 2011 than any other sheriff in jail in the state. Over that 5 years, the state spent about $6 million resolving claims and wrongdoing against the Richmond Jail and Sheriff's Office. For example, in 2016, six inmates died while in the city jail. Do you think this is reasonable and acceptable given the population of the jail that includes mentally ill and drug addicts?
No, I can answer that right off the bat. No, it's not reasonable. It's totally unreasonable. In doing my background work on the kinds of things that investigation reports and audits have turned up on the jail, I found one incident where over a period of time, there were not only no rounds being made, they weren't even recording rounds. And this is in modern times. As I listen to Nicole, and this is eyewitness, she's seen what's going on down there. It's mind-boggling to me that you would not certify officers, that you would not have them know how to perform proper body searches, even short of having a magnetometer or a whole body scan. But again, it's part of the course and what we've all been hearing. We all lived here. We've been hearing the stories that are released that come out of the jail. We've been hearing them. So this is no surprise. Only thing now we're getting is details, okay? What this goes to really, and there's no other way to look at this, is leadership and disconnect. You have to start with the statute. What the statute say that the policy is promulgated from? Then you have to go from the policy to the procedure. Then you have to make sure that people are doing this. How do you do that? You make sure they're training. You make sure that you have certified people training them and conducting your training. It's a step procedure. You can't just jump in with the procedure. You have to be able to come from, what does the statute say? Statute say you should be doing this. What does the Virginia Administrative Code say? That's another statute that governs corrections. And jails are governed by correctional statutes, okay? So you have to look at it all in context, but it all is set at the top. That connection, your in-service training, you can't wait until an incident happens and then start having in-service training. In-service training must be done based on, one, in a timely fashion, because your certification requirements call for in-service training. But also, when you got your staff on, and as I spoke to earlier, your staff have to be focused. And when they're focused on this and they're engaging with offenders, they're able to tell when somebody's not really clicking, something's on their mind, or something's going on. That's what I call, that's what I've called in my units, detect and deter. In other words, you can't just be sitting at the desk or in the control room, maybe kicking it or whatever. You have to be actually out there engaged at all times. And when you're engaged with these offenders, what you find out is that they will share with you what got them there. If you will listen to them and talk to them, they will share that with you. I admit that not all officers are good counselors, and not all counselors make good officers. But I do know that when you talk to them, they will share with you what's going on with them. And when you see what's really going on, you'll be able to de-escalate things before they happen. And in every security setting that I've ever worked in, my whole focus has been on spot the behavior first, respond to what you're seeing, and report it as need be. And the end result of that is that you have less of those situations. And then you have less people going into the bathroom, not coming out the bathroom because they die on the commode. You know, you have to do your job. And so while I can bring staff together, I make it clear, you are responsible for what you do. And I'm gonna hold you accountable. No sheriff can stay in the office all the time. They have lives too. So you have to put people in place that not only can you go go back to the decisions that are being made at the top, at the administrative level. It's just not good risk versus reward. Take care of the person right then and there, take care of the situation right then and there, and you won't have that escalation in damages and costs and constantly getting settlements and judgments against you. There's a disconnect and a detachment. And what I'm going to do from day one, there's like 460 employees down there, you're going to have to. And regardless of which one of us gets it, we're going to be facing the same problem. We're going to have to assess each one of those divisions to make sure they're in compliance with policy. Thank you.
Thank you.
As far as the lawsuits being reasonable, no, it's not reasonable. But it all starts with leadership and training. Having a leader that can motivate individuals to do the job that they've been trained to do a good job because they want to be of good service to the citizens of the city of Richmond. Training is where it starts. CIT, which is the crisis intervention training. In Henrico, the sworn officers as well as civilians go through that training, prior training, to ensure that everyone's aware of the Prison Rape Elimination Act, making sure that the staff members are able to have great observation skills so that they can know what's going on. They have good communication skills. Not saying everybody's gonna be on 100 with all of them, but if you have enough individuals that are keen in the job that they're doing, they're observing and they're watching, they're communicating with the actual inmates, they know what's going on their tier, they are working hard every day to make sure that the job gets done, then you can reduce the amount of incidents that occur. Will there be deaths in the jail? Absolutely. There will be deaths, just like any other deaths that there are. However, if you put the proper training in place, we can be very proactive on some of those things. As far as individuals making sure that they get their medications, and making sure that if they belong on medication, that they should be taking their medication. There are different ways to do that, whether it's some individuals that can control their own medications with PRNs, which they will have on their persons, and that they can protect those medicines, or whether it's individuals that we need to make sure that they are taking their medicine. There's a tracking system to make sure that they're taking their medicine and how much medicine that they have. So we need to make sure that people are being treated. If they say they're sick, we can't just say that they're trying to blow smoke. We have to make sure that they're seen by medical officials to ensure that if it is true that they're receiving the treatment. And I say, well, all you keep saying is something's wrong with you. It only takes that one time for something actually to be wrong with someone for something to happen. So we can't just say, well, he's always saying that something's wrong. Doesn't matter. If the staff, if you are a sworn staff member and you're working in corrections, law enforcement, you are a deputy sheriff, then your job is to make sure that they get the medical or mental health treatment that they're supposed to get. They say they're sick, take them. If they can't get there, you get them there. If you can't get them there, get medical to them. It's our responsibility to make sure that they get that treatment that they're supposed to have. I wasn't aware until I did some new research that sheriff's office didn't have crisis intervention training. Almost, they would be the 0% of all the law enforcement and corrections agents in the city and in this state that don't have. Everybody else has it. Why wouldn't you have it? Why wouldn't you have your sworn and your civilian staff up to par on that to make sure that you know how to deal with different types of people that may have different types of issues? Not saying everybody is on a drug. There's some type of addiction. There's some type of behavior problem. But we need to be able to recognize that. And we have to be able to treat people with dignity and respect. If we're treating people a certain way just because they are incarcerated and they are an inmate and we don't want to have to deal with them, then we're going to ignore things that happen to them. And yeah. That goes back to training and hiring to make sure that we hire the right people and that we train them once we get them to make sure that they actually care about the job that they're doing. It's not just about getting a paycheck when you work in these types of jobs. It's not. And anybody that's worked in this field knows it's not about the paycheck. It's about making sure that you can serve people and make sure that people get treated properly, they get treated fairly and humanely. So we want to make sure it starts with the leadership, you know, and I've been told I can motivate an etching of a rock and take it wherever it needs to go. So you want to be able to motivate your people to do a good job. The morale is low, I don't like my job, I'm not going to pay attention, I really don't care what happens to the enemy. Because because I really don't want to be here. I'm just coming to get my check until whoever else leaves.
Yep.
It starts with the leadership. If you have poor leadership, you're going to have poor staff. And it's unfortunate because there are some very good people that work there and they want to do a good job each and every day. And we have to make sure, all of us have to make sure that they're given the opportunity to do a good job and do the right job because they know how to do their job.
Okay.
Don't steal his notes.
All right, next question. And these questions come from the audience, okay? First one is, Antoinette, and you go first. Would you take a leadership role with the Virginia Sheriff's Association and lobbying the General Assembly to eliminate the revoking of driver's license for felony offenses and outstanding fees and fines? So if you elect the sheriff, would you take a leadership role in the Sheriff's Association, would you go down to the Capitol Square and lobby the General Assembly to change that particular law?
As far as read the law you want me to take?
Well, we will take someone's driver's license from them for being a felon or for outstanding fees and fines.
Well, the thing about that, yes, I would lobby with the General Assembly, not just for that, but a lot of other laws that we need to look at and reevaluate as far as those things that are holding individuals down in order to be able to have jobs and be able to get to those jobs and being able to provide for their families. So as far as making sure that individuals can get their driver's license back, yes, there's a need for that. Because it's as if we're punishing people more than once. An individual has served their time and now we're telling them, you can't drive. Even if we need to work on restricted licensing to a certain time, if that's what we need to do to ensure that they can get to their jobs and get to the places that they need to get to. We don't want to continue to punish people or discipline people for things that they've already served their time for. We want to make sure that they can get their lives back on track. And you can't get your life back on track if you're still being held in bondage by the things that you've done in the past. So we want to make sure we do that, not just with that, but with other things, and I'll address that in my closing.
Thank you.
Yes.
Oh, would you go next? Same question.
I would have to say yes, I would lobby as well. I kind of feel the same way she does as far as, you know, somebody who's been to crime and you continue to let them pay for that crime over and over and over again. I also think we need to have some partnerships with the judicial officers as well, and also the Commonwealth Attorney's offices, and also the clerk's offices, so that we can talk about some other things in respect to not just about the licenses, but some other things, looking at bonds, maybe people getting weekend time and people being on electronic monitoring and things like that, and as an alternative to fines and doing jail time and stuff like that. So I would say yes.
Thank you.
Now, on the surface, on the space, I definitely would say yes. But having worked with the statutory aspects of it, you have to look at what you're asking them to do. Clearly, the ongoing burden of having somebody who just completed their time now not be able to go back and drive maybe their mom's car or their girlfriend's car to work, you're hampering them. And if you hamper them like that, you place an undue burden on them. So clearly that needs to be, it's already being addressed. I don't know if they've taken that avenue yet, but there's been a lot of pushback against that. But like Anthony said, that's one of many such laws that burden people like that. When you've done your time, they want to keep on having you be burdened. And so certainly I would be definitely on board with joining in with fellow officers, fellow sheriffs, and approaching the delegates and making sure that these kinds of laws are fair and that they're connected. Oftentimes, when you look at the draft behind these laws, they're not even connected to anything the person did. They serve no purpose in terms of any kind of redemptive value, any kind of keeping their recidivism. Actually, what you're doing is you're putting that person under more pressure to go back into the community, and then it's a we and them thing all over again. They're going to recommit a crime because they say, well, why should I do anything? why should I do anything? I've done my time, and now I can't even get my driver's license. I didn't even do anything at DMV. And so you have to look at the impacts, and that I think comes in with what avenues are you going to take. Delegates are real crafty people. They know you're going to come at them to try to change the law, but you're going to have a strategy. And amongst the strategies that you have, if you can show that these people, once put upon again by the system like this, they're going to recommit. They're going to go back out there, and you've lessened their avenues for success. And when you lessen an offender's avenues for success, you create recidivism.
Thank you. Nicole, you can take the next question first. Presently, the city jail charges $2 a day for inmates. This charge is also deducted against the inmate's account for money their family may leave with them. And the question is, why is this expense deducted from funds the inmate's family may put on their account instead of having a separate account? Many of these families already experience financial hardship. So is that something, I think it's something that may be fair, would you keep that in the city jail? Or would you do away with that process?
I would like to eliminate that process. The reason being is a lot of times the family members are already having a hard time financially. And they're trying to support their families, they're trying to put food on the table, they're trying to put a roof over their head. And to have to try to come down to the jail and grab their family member that's incarcerated, and then that money's being taken directly out of their account every single day. That money adds up. And my thing is, if you're gonna continue to take money from them while they're there, by the time they get out of jail, they're gonna own the jail. So I definitely think that we need to eliminate that process. I know the sheriffs can use a discretionary, period to say, hey, I wanna charge or I don't, but it is definitely the sheriff's decision as to whether or not they're gonna charge those inmates, but I definitely will not continue to keep that in place.
All right. Thank you.
The short answer to that is, no, we do not have those charged inmates to the system. I've worked in the system over 26 years and we have not charged them a day of the rent fee. Thank you.
Amongst one of the most absurd things that I've ever heard. You know, if you got a person who probably didn't have the money when he came in, so now you're in a debt situation. I don't get it. But look, I'm not going to stop with just that. There's other things and ways that it's like an unjust enrichment. When you start talking about canteen, you're talking about charging them really exorbitant kind of prices for the very lowest kinds of products. The whole thing, the whole situation is going to have to be reevaluated. The vendors, it starts with going out and making fresh relationships with your vendors. You know, so they'll if you tell them that you have 1,200 inmates, 1,500 inmates, 2,000 inmates, don't you think they won't make no deal with you? But you have to care about the inmate. You can't just go to work every day. You know, you can't just, it's not just about the paycheck. And I think all of us have said that. It's not just about the paycheck. You're not flipping hamburgers here. You won't do it on my watch. You won't do it on my watch. Some people are retraining. If I come in and catch you, you might be a good person. I might be able to use somewhere else. But I can't have you in there basically dogging our people. And that's what, overall, this whole thing about charging them, it's like you want to make them pay and continue to pay. This goes back to the DMV charge. You know, you got them in there, and they're not paying, the family's paying. They don't have any money. And then you're going to leave out of there, and what, now they're in a deficit situation. They owe the jail. They owe restitution at the court. They owe everybody. So a lot of those prices, you got to look at a lot of this stuff that just has been set up. And you also got to follow the money tree. You know, who's getting the money off the top? I mean, where's the money going? Is the money going to enrich them? Is that money going to set up some kind of vocational fund so that you can keep literature and bring people in to explain to them, well, what's a plumber's assistant? What is a plumber's apprentice? You know, you have to be able to channel that mindset. They're a captive audience. It's about what you use that time for. But to your question, no question. All that's got to go. That's ridiculous.
And stay there for the next question. And if you believe that it is your duty as a constitutional office to challenge the laws that you believe are wrong.
Yes, yes I do. I guess I laugh because I don't really know much about the other candidates and their interaction, but I would dare say I'm the only candidate that's running that's constantly engaged with the court standard. And what I found is that, you know, what you hear about on TV, on the news, and the inequities, and it's always vague, unless we get in that precise situation where somebody's been mistreated. It's real vague. But the reality is, oftentimes the laws and the practices and the procedures that they're doing, there's absolutely no basis for them. You go into the courtroom, you go into the courthouse. I had a judge, and I'm going to say this, basically just threw away my evidence. He threw it away. So my answer to you is, you must challenge him. You must. And I think that's one of the reasons that our politicians and our officers, not merely constitutional, but our public officers as well, have gotten so far out on the fringes, is because once everybody else gets in the office, it's like buddy-buddy. Nobody calls anybody into play anymore. And maybe they're afraid that they won't be invited to somebody's Labor Day picnic or something. I don't care. I'll be with my granddaughters in my backyard. But you know, I walk down to the courts, I do it respectfully, they still want me there, but I still do it. And you have to tell people, until we start holding our counterparts, our public official peers in check, this is going to remain rampant. What you're seeing, some of the stuff that we saw with the prior administration, those kinds of things, just mind-boggling. But again, I would say, yes, you have to challenge. You have a bullet pulpit, and you have to do it. Your responsibility is to the citizen. I don't have a responsibility to no public official. I want to offend them, but if they're doing what they're supposed to be doing, they don't have to worry about being offended.
That's right.
All right. All right.
Yes, to that question, I've always been known as the person that doesn't just go along. So I'm going to challenge things, and I feel indirectly, as well as citizens here in the city of Richmond. This is the responsibility of a good leader to ensure that everything's done fairly and humanely. And yes, I will have a direct line across the street. It's going to be my goal to at least we have a conversation with across the street or down the street to make sure. And I have made him the promises, and you know, I've been the 12-year stepchild, so I don't owe anybody anything. So my goal is to hold other people accountable as well in our city to make sure that our citizens are being properly served and properly cared for.
Thank you.
Yes, I would be a challenging sheriff when it comes to certain laws. I've always been the type to stand up for my people and stand up for what is right and to implement the things that I feel is going to best benefit the sheriff department and also the citizens of Richmond. The sheriff we report to you, the citizens. We work for you, the citizens. And whatever decisions that are made by the sheriff, that the citizens themselves should be considered first in every situation that comes up. So I definitely think that I would definitely challenge, no question about it.
Coach Stanley, this will be the last question for the night for the sheriff candidates when you leave your selection. Last question. And it's right along the same lines as the one you just answered. If you become sheriff, Nicole, will you refuse to cooperate with immigration and custom enforcement when it comes down to detaining or turning over immigrants to ICE custody?
As sheriff, I would follow the policy that's set out by city government and state government. And I'm just not sure if any of you know, once a person is incarcerated and their fingerprints go into the state database, ICE is connected into that database.
So they already have knowledge that an individual has been taken into custody. So that's not really direct information coming from the sheriff himself. That information is put into the database. I will not pick up my phone and say, hey, ICE, I have so-and-so here in my jail. No, I will not do that. If there is a warrant or a detainer to hold that individual, then by law, I'm obligated to hold them. But I will not be reaching out to ICE, calling them if someone enters into my jail. And if they've already been under the ICE radar and their fingerprints go into the system, then they will automatically be notified.
Okay. I wrote that question.
Same type of response. There's a law that's put in place, and we have to go along with that law. It's not as if we're going to notify them, because again, they're already notified when the person gets in the system. They troll the internet and the database just like our kids do, so they know when someone's arrested. They know when they come, the police officers are picking them up. So no, it's not that I'm going to call them or encourage them to come and pick up anyone. But again, if they have warrants or detainers, then we have to hold them by law. Otherwise, we're not just going to invite them in and say, hey, come get them, or give them a seat in the building and say, you know, watch people come through the door and you can take them as they go. So that's not our goal. Our goal is to follow the law and also be respectful to our citizens, or respectful to the people that work, sleep, eat, and play, and pay bills here in the city.
Okay.
Thank
you.
Every offender that's committed, juvenile, adult, male, or female, comes with a specific set of instructions, and that's in the commitment order. Once the people in that division tell me that the time is up, the time is up. So don't call me, you know, don't come knocking at the door, ICE or anybody else. You know, that's not my job. My job is to carry out the edicts of the commitment order. And that's what I train my staff to do, and that's what I will do. Anything else, I don't have the time or use for it.
Thank you. Mm-hmm.
Thank you. We're going to do closing statements now. Before we do that, let's give these sheriff candidates a big hand of applause. Nicole, would you like to go first?
First, I want to thank you for staying this late, listening to what we have to say. I really appreciate it. I know we talked about quite a few things here today. We talked about security out of jail. We talked about mental health. We talked about programs for individuals when they're leaving incarceration, or programs internally. We talked about ICE and a whole lot of other things. But the main thing I want to bring to your attention is that as sheriff, you have to have connections with your people. You have to have the voices of your people as well to help you along the way. A sheriff's position is not something that you can do alone. You're gonna need other people to help you. And that is what I'm all about. Partnershiping with other people. Investing in other people to come into what we're trying to do to make what we're trying to do better. I believe that the Richmond Sheriff Department can be a great department, but with more training and advanced training, better leadership, securing our jail and our courthouses is only going to enhance where we're trying to go and where I'm trying to take the sheriff's office. I want you to consider all three candidates here, and I want you to think about, you know, who's, as Jafar pointed out earlier, I've been there, I've been here, I've been in the city serving the city residents for over 20-something years. I have knowledge and understanding of city issues. I have knowledge and understanding of what it takes to communicate with our citizens here in Richmond. So I want you to think about that and take that into consideration, my background in law enforcement and my ability to partnership with other agencies within the city, such as the Commonwealth Attorney's Office, the judicial offices, and the clerks of the city of Richmond. So I want you to study your candidates, think about what we said here tonight. I want you to think about when you go out and vote, who's the better candidate? who actually came up here and gave you a plan of action of what they wanted to do, and now said what needs to be done, but also had a plan already in place. Someone that's being proactive already, and they haven't even been elected yet. Think about the type of person that they're gonna be once they are sheriff. They're gonna take and look at a situation and plan out everything that needs to be done before it needs to be done. And that's the kind of leadership we need in the city jail, in addition to promoting healthy work environments. We are definitely lacking in that, but as I said again, if we make our employees feel valued, and we make them feel like they're a part of something, and we make them feel like they're important, they're gonna wanna stay. And when they start talking about how great the Richmond City Sheriff's Office is, and how much they love to come to work, and how much fun they have, and how many incentives that they have, they're gonna tell other people. And other people are gonna wanna become a part of the Richmond Sheriff's Office, and that's how you build your team. And I would like to see the Sheriff's Office grow and expand way more than what we've ever done before. I want us to be the model sheriff department in the state. I want other sheriff's offices to follow us. I'm tired of following them. And we also need to utilize the resources that we already have in the sheriff's office. Like I said before, utilizing deputies to assist in the city. That is what it's about. All of us working together as a team, making this city safer for all residents. Thank you very much.
Well, I guess I've been a sheriff since I was a little boy. My daddy called me a sheriff. I had no idea what he was talking about. But as I've grown up and I've worked in a number of different settings and done a number of different things, I've run for a number of different offices, because I thought I could help make it better of everything that I've ever even attempted to do. Being a sheriff is it. Talk to my old brother, he can tell you what. But what are the things that kind of shape you along the way? When do you notice? You know, I think about some of the situations that I had with mid-70s. I'm a 21-year-old, and at this point I have transitioned from being a correctional officer. I'm now a mess steward. I'm 21 years old. I'm responsible for portion control. I'm responsible for making sure they set the line up and they break it down. I'm responsible for making sure the yeast and sugar don't just disappear. I'm responsible for making sure that everybody gets what they're supposed to get. Now that's policy. But I want you to know that in the back of the jail, a sheriff's deputy, sheriff, nobody has a badge and a gun. I mean, you got the badge, but you don't have the gun. The gun is something that you see publicly. In the back of the jail, what you have respect and dignity for one another. And don't get it wrong, when you step out on the tier or anywhere else, you're one of a number and you are outnumbered. So you can't come across like you're all that. I'm gonna share this one situation with you and hopefully that'll tell you my commitment to what it is I do. I can use a lot of words, I can tell you about textbooks, but what you do when you're under pressure varies from person to person. And it's one particular situation, I had a guy working for me, he was a guy named Kimmel, I'm gonna call him George Kimmel, Philadelphia. He was a boxer. I'm 21 years old, I'm the youngest person on the staff. All right? I got older stewards working alongside me. And so, there are two things that they serve in the correctional meal setting that can cause you a riot, and that's chicken and steak. Today we had chicken, that day we had chicken. So Kimmel comes to me, and before the meal is full, all the inmates get together in one side, all of them that's working, pulling the chow down, get together, and they sit and they eat. And so they have a conversation, quote unquote, telling lies, talking to each other, and keeping each other laughing. That's fine, but that's good for morale. All right, so Kimmel tells me, he said, well, when my boy comes through the line, I'm gonna give him 2 pieces of chicken. And so I'm looking at him saying, okay, how do you handle this? The policy says you will get what everybody else gets. And in addition to that policy, we had a practice in place where once the line was fully the first time, you get to come back through, and you get a second piece then. So now, no, Kimmel, he's really messing with me now. He want to see how I handle it. I'm the youngest person out there. Will I adhere to the policy, or what will I do? Okay? Guy comes through the line, he gives him 2 pieces of chicken. I didn't say anything to him. And my fellow messengers, they look at me and say, well, man, you should have just left that alone. You know, leave it alone, you know, he'll come back tomorrow, he'll be gone. No, it won't be gone. Because it's critical there that the policy works for everybody.
Yeah.
Policy must work for everybody. In that kind of situation, I walked right to the back office, I charged him. When he came back there, he swung on me, blooded my nose and everything. We wrestled. He got his extra 3 or 4 years. But I tell you all that to say this. Reading a policy from a book and a manual is one thing. But when you're face to face with the person under those kinds of situations, that's where the rubber really meets the road. Now, from that day on, they work better together in the mess hall. I got no more problems, and no more mess crews got any problems. So I say all of that to say that when you pull together, it's going to be difficult when you confront that kind of behavior and that mindset. But that's what I want to bring to this job. I want to bring a demonstrated capacity to confront what needs to be confronted, pull people together, and get that kind of outcome that's called by policy and procedure. Thanks for having me in. I appreciate it.
I too want to thank you all. I want to thank you, Crusade, for having this forum. I know it's getting late. But on November 7th, I asked for your vote for sheriff here in the city of Richmond. And I asked for you in the Crusade, I asked for your endorsement because I believe that I am the candidate that can bring the best tools and resources and the best leadership skills to the city of Richmond. The sheriff's office embodies a lot of different things. The jail, the courts, transportation, civil process, communication and interpersonal relations with other people. We need to be able to do that in the community as well as inside of our facilities. We interact with thousands of individuals on a daily basis, whether they're coming into the jails or coming into the courthouse, whether our staff are going out and serving eviction notices or summonses or whatever it is. We have to make sure that our individuals are putting on the best product to represent the citizens of the city of Richmond. And we have to make sure that we're doing that each and every day. And that starts with leadership and it starts with training. We have to make sure that we have a good leader in place, and I feel that I am that leader.
Yes.
I've been in leadership roles the majority of the time that I've been at the sheriff's office. And it's not about which sheriff's office you've worked for or which building you've worked in or which institution or whatever you've worked in. It's about how it is that you can get people motivated to do the best possible job that they can get done. It's how you treat people, how you respect people, having accountability and responsibility and respect for other people. Because the sheriff's office is about life, health, and safety. Those three tools are what it is that it takes to make sure that your agency can put on the best product for the individuals that are living there or those individuals that visit those facilities. We have to make sure that even the individuals that don't live in the city are seeing us at our best at all times. Because at any time, anyone can come through the city of Richmond and end up at the city center or end up in one of our courtrooms. So we have to make sure that we're always putting on the best product. And I feel with the over 26 years of experience that I have in the sheriff's office in leadership and management, being able to mediate, being able to make sure that I can deal with conflict and talk people, I can talk my way in or out of anything. I just want to make sure that we build those relationships with other agencies. We want to build those relationships with the individuals that are incarcerated. We want to build those relationships with the community, whether it's a for-profit, a non-profit, a business. We don't really care who it is. We want to make sure that we build positive relationships because those relationships are going to affect the individuals that are incarcerated in our facility. So we want to make sure that we give them the proper tools and resources so that when they re-enter our communities, that they are able to live good, sustainable lives and able to take care of their families and that they're able to be a productive citizen in our community. It's our responsibility to make sure that we can deter the things that are going to happen once they get out. Because if we send a bad product back out, we're only adding to the criminal activities that are going on in our city. Whether it's happening as a result of that individual or someone in their family because they see that the system is just broken. So we need to be able to fix the system. We need to work every day to make sure that the system is putting on the best possible product. And we need to build relationships with the people in our community to make sure that they can say, it's not a us versus them. There are many inmates that I spoke to, and it wasn't a me against them. They come past my house, they talk. I found out more information cutting my grass than I did walking up and down the hall because that relationship that I built with them while I was there, they would come and tell me what was going on. And I would make a call, and it was going on in the facility. So we need to make sure we can build that relationship that they need to be able to trust, that the leadership that you're putting out there is a leadership that they can ensure that's going to help them.